Yeah. Kia Beats. Yo, Kia, what up? I used to be scared of pigs, judges and wigs, authority abusers, inside tinted cruisers. Pull out batons, get Negro's head crack on. Stuff vests with drug notes they stole from a thug's coat. Thugs buy pigs drugs and never get caught up. Use trade tricks, these servants are made dicks. Have the front lines with dummies that know no law, to make you assume that they know no law. Smarter than a fifth grader, rights violators, oaths and badges, but I can so savage. No intellect to object or interject, civilly dead passes all get intercept. Foul balls get caught, Negro leaders swinging and missing deliberate. Your head they deliver it to the front and pharaoh, dressing like your ancestors. Study, study, study Moorish holy Quran lessons.
Don't be fooled by the leaders saying they black, taking yellow envelopes, weighing they stacks. Sold you out to the lodge and government corpses, sacrificed their own to their pale guard bosses. Don't be fooled by the leaders saying they black, taking yellow envelopes, weighing they stacks. Sold you out to the lodge and government corpses, sacrificed their own to their pale guard bosses.
Moore's been telling, never to the point of yelling, like black power cowards slaving, never
rebelling. Welcome everybody. Appreciate everybody being here, taking some of the long drives to be out here with us today. Today's class / lecture was sponsored by good sister Black, Sister Mona L. So we're familiar because we do music together. She's an extraordinary producer. She has two songs on the new album that's back here. Wanna also send a shout out to RBA Publications for making herself present. And of course, everybody here, thank you for being here. The presentation class / lecture today is about who's the real American. Before we get into that, you know, as usual, we got to put Mo Drawley on the record to make sure that his message is loud and clear. We're going to read a few readings from Mo Drawley, and hopefully they will make Mo Drawley clear to the people who aren't too familiar with Mo Drawley. Oh, Lord, the Lord's body. I'm going to be a captain.
This is our sister, man. Good to see you.
Yeah, we are. Thank you. You got the black feather on there. So this is to the members of the War Science Temple of America. Also, don't get caught up in the perspective that has been floating around that members belong to, you know, the organization of the War Science Temple. When Mo Drawley referenced members, it was synonymous with citizens. Right, because in actuality, just like the 13 colonies were classified as companies, right? The same thing with Morris Science Temple of America, it's classified as a company or a corporation. But when we do deeper research into the colonies, you find out that the colonies were also called countries. But they were corporations though. But they were called countries. So it's the same perspective with the Morris Science Temple. That when Mo Drawley said members of the Morris Science Temple, he's talking about citizens of the country of Morocco. Because he told us in our teachings that we're Moorish because we're descendants of Moroccans. And then if we're descendants of Moroccans, then we have to, our domicile has to be Morocco. But the perspective that's taught is that Morocco is, you know, when Morocco's really over here. Morocco's really in the jurisdiction of, you know, Mexico, so-called U.S., so-called Canada, Greenland, whatever, that's all Morocco, the farthest west that I can talk about. Got a question, sister?
I was just going to say, yeah, the Morocco over there would be considered a kingdom, but this is the empire.
Right, right. So the empire is never subordinate. Like there's never a time where the empire is looked at as the lowest form of whatever, whether it's geographical landmass, whether it's political, economic, whatever. The empire is always supersedes, right? So, to the members of the Moorish Science Temple of America, Islam, this is the instruction from your prophet, Muhammad Ali. Be faithful unto your forefathers' divine and national creed, that you will be blessed for your good deeds that you sow in the flesh. Allah is the one that judges the world, and his judgment is not on, but the weak can comprehend it not. The end of time is drawing near, so says Allah to his divine prophet, Ayn al-Jawali. And that's why many hearts have been turned to stone, and many have eyes to see but cannot see, ears to hear but cannot hear, lest they would be confounded of their sins. These are trying hours now, dear Moors, and every evil spirit is moving, and they are trying every weak mind to overthrow and drag off the true foundation that has been laid, and to cause confusion in the minds of the ones that do believe. But if you have the true love of Allah and the spirit of your forefathers, you fear not what you hear or see, but you will sacrifice the utmost of your very life to protect your movement and your prophet. Watch your enemies, dear Moors. Your enemies are the ones that speak against your prophet and ridicule him to the very lowest, and the ones that speak against your divine and national principles of your temples. Act accordingly, and Allah will bless you for your good work. Peace, your divine prophet, Muhammad Ali. So that's one of the readings that you might not hear them talk about when you visit these places called Moorish Science Temples. And because of the infiltration of the temples is why you don't hear about certain things. Because of opportunists, people realizing what the Moorish movement is and recognizing that they can actually benefit in their life from presenting it to the people in the wrong perspective. So majority of the lessons that Muhammad Ali presented to the people are sort of put over here. They'll do it kind of when it comes up, but they'll openly speak about, you know, Holy Quran of Moorish Science Temple, a 101 questionnaire, and you know, we're Moors and Prophet Muhammad Ali and red flag, green star, but the words that he spoke, which is really what this is about, what the things that he relayed to the Moors, so that they can be clear in their mind what it is that he brought them, right? Because if we look at, you know, we always, as Moors, use other nations as examples, right? So when we look at other nations out there, there's no other nation out there that has to get taught about their nationality. They would go through stuff like this. They don't do stuff like this. We're the only ones that do this. And I mean, we do it because it's something that we have to do right now. But in the time of Muhammad Ali, it was common theme that, you know, constitutionists spoke about, civics is taught, you know, languages are taught. Certain things were happening during that time. Nowadays, you don't necessarily have that. Because the people, like we said, the infiltration, they took the position of letting the infiltrators took the position of teaching wrong perspectives to the members. So instead of the members taking the position of recognizing that this is theirs, and because it's theirs, dealing with it accordingly is not. Dealing with it how it's supposed to be dealt with, they sit back and wait for the leadership to do it. when the leadership knows that that's not their job to really be doing anything unless the people say, do the job. So they created this passive perspective, right? So in bringing these things up, these letters, these things that Noam Djawadi said, it's to get the people to recognize that, you know, Noam Djawadi said, imitate I, your prophet, right? And then when you read his writings, it's from a first party perspective. So we're talking about Noam Djawadi, but we're saying I. We're not saying Noam Djawadi said, we don't know this, know that, we're like, I said. So we can have the mentality of what the prophet had during that time today. And then that is also how you get this thing of reincarnated prophets. I am gonna do this and that. Speaking from the prophet in a first person perspective, but the leadership taking it like, oh, so that means I'm the prophet. So then they're gonna say, you know, reincarnated prophet. They're gonna say, you look at the Nation of Islam, where in all their pictures they have, you know, Fard in the corner, kind of looking down on the picture. And then everybody in the picture is kind of worshiping him like he's Allah. When Nation of Gods and Earth's teachings tell you that 1910 Fard met Noam Djawadi. But they're not gonna talk from that perspective, because as soon as they start bringing up Noam Djawadi, all these people who founded their whatever after 1930 become mute, become unimportant, which is what they don't want. Because remember, we're talking about people who are opportunists. They already have in their mind that I can get their pockets. Before they say, give up the money, they already know. We're going to go in their pockets, we're going to go in his pockets. Anybody who comes in the door says that they want to be members of whatever, and then they're going to have the amity banner on this side, and then they're going to have the mocking flag on this side and say that's more sidestepping. When the amity banner is supposed to be in the middle, and then the Bunker Hill flag is supposed to be on this side, the red flag, green cedar tree on it and all that. But if they take that off and then just show you the, then it appears that, you know, the amity banner is on this side, and then when really the amity banner is in the middle, because that's supposed to be creating the contract, right? To be proclaimed at every meeting. And if anybody has, you know, comments, whatever like that, just, you know, shout it up, put it up there.
Quick question, the first letter you read, what was that letter title?
To the members of the Morissette Temple of America.
Islam.
So to be proclaimed at every meeting, Islam. I'm glad to know that I have a few faithful Moors among you all, and I desire for them to know the truth and the divine truth. There is a host of jealousy about me and the movement now by the same people on our side of the nation that claim it was only a joke and unreal. But now, since they have found out from the government officials and the nations of the earth that this is the only sole foundation that all Asiatics must depend upon for their earthly salvation as American citizens, not as Morissette Temple members, as American citizens. But this is to be proclaimed in every meeting, which the meetings is what happens with the members of the Morissette Temple. But in the letter he's talking about citizens, letting people know the perspective that he's wanting this to be given him. And if it's not given in that perspective, I don't care if they got a sign, they have pheasants on, flag and all that type of stuff, they're not more science than more. Because this has to be presented as civic for the people. Because this is really the salvation. This is really where our freedom comes from. By having our own body politic, that, you know, citizenry, our own membership, that only we can benefit from this. Nobody else has to benefit from this, especially if they are already a nation and they have stuff they've been benefiting from already. They don't need this. It's our people that need this. But if it's not taught from that perspective, then you're gonna have people saying things like, well, what does it mean to be a Moor? Why should I be a Moor? Stupid stuff like that. right? Because they're looking at the Moors that infiltrated as the Moors, and then the Moors who, you know, are being active, they're looked at as against what Mogujwali brought, whatever like that, when the real ones against Mogujwali are the ones who are right now today call themselves granting their temple or whatever. Right now today call themselves reincarnated prophets of whatever. Right now today, Mogujwali says nationality, and they're pushing naturalized people. And saying that they're more science temple and Moorish movement and things relative to Moors, when half, 75% to 80% of people considering themselves leadership Moors, they work for you guys, democracy, guaranteed. Right?
Yeah, but if I can add on to what you're saying with working for the UDOT, it's not democracy. That goes right in conjunction with what you just read about Mogujwali bringing it back to American citizens.
Right.
Post the United States citizens.
Exactly. Right. They are working every scheme that they can to disqualify me so they may take charge of the situation. Right? Which is, you know, that's prophecy. Right? That's not some statement or whatever. That's prophecy. Because those same people who worked every scheme, call themselves reincarnated prophet, all this stuff right now, they're the ones that are in charge. Pretending that, yeah, they're the legitimate successors of Mogujwali. Well, there's no successors of Mogujwali, Islam. Right? The only successors of Mogujwali are the beneficiaries, which are the individuals who came to save them. And that's it. Anybody else claim that they have some powers that Mogujwali gave them, but he never gave you, but he gave it to them, but you never got it? People are running some game on you. But Mogujwali came to free his people. Right? He came to free his people. I have notified all these things to you long ago in the past. It is through the faithful Moors that attribute to the movement and uplifting funds. The ones that pay their divine respect to me and the movement will be remembered. That is why I'm calling upon all faithful Moors to increase their faithfulness to me, your prophet, and your divine Moorish movement. Right? So he made a call back then to all faithful Moors to increase their faithfulness. Which means that there were no faithful Moors back then. And if he's going to make statements like, there's only going to be a handful of saves and fingers left over and stuff like that, obviously there was nobody around him that was backing him back then. He was a lone ranger back then. That's how much people are against this. That's why the Moorish movement hasn't made the progress that the Vatican's made. The Vatican was founded in 1932. How come they get so far and we're only right here? How come, you know, there's no Unity Hall still? Why haven't the Unity Hall? Where is that? How come there's all these manufacturing companies that Moors had during Mogujwali's time aren't around today? And all things just disappeared just like that? You even hear, if Target's closing, you hear Target's closing. You know what I mean? They didn't even make any, they didn't mention that. You know what? More science funds are closing down or whatever like that. They just, you know, people go there, the door's locked. Where's the temple? All right, I guess it's shut down or whatever. Not only that was infiltration. Right? I need finance and I need it badly. Never before have I needed finance so badly as I do at present, so I can shove aside the discord that is facing the nation. I'm facing the more science temple, the discord that's facing the nation. It all comes from jealousy because of my fame and nobility. The nations of the world will not recognize the movement without I, the prophet, being head. It has been proven by my works which I have performed in the past few years, Prophet Mogujwali. A warning from the prophet for all governors and grand chiefs and head officials of the temples. Right? So this is so that you know what he told the head people that are still around today, playing around like this is, you know, come to the temple and just sing hymns to Mogujwali, pray to him and all that. Renew your acts, amend your ways. Right? So I already telling people from the jump that these guys have been running a fraud. Right? Because the Great Conference is on its way, and it is where the law will be enforced before the great grand body. So when you hear mention of the grand body of the Moorish movement, the grand body of the Moorish movement is the nation. Anybody say the grand body is some group of Arabs that have all the information and nobody else has it? That doesn't make sense. That the grand body is eight Moors. Okay? It doesn't even make sense. The continuance of the present officers in the temple will depend on their past good work. Those who have been delinquent, and so you know that people are prepared. Those who have been delinquent may now know that they will not be tolerated any longer, because this great divine and national movement must move according to the law. These things shall be proclaimed. There is no favorite in any of the temples. So the old guys say, we're reincarnated. Those guys aren't reincarnated. Then nobody picked us as the successors of whatever. There's no favorites. Everybody has their role to play, if they want to play, role, right? Just like, RBA has a role to play. They play their role very well, right? Then it's not something that they got commissioned to start putting out information that people don't have with regard to this. They took it on themselves to say, okay, you know what? We need to provide this for people that have information. And it's the same thing with every individual who says that they're Moorish American. Don't be intimidated by them telling you, oh, you can't, and, well, you gotta be, you need this, you need that, in order to be. Right? It's not needed. The whole objective is for our people to take their place in the affairs of men. The whole purpose is for our people to take their place. And the only way that you're going to take your place is by having this information. Because you can't take your place as Negro, Black, Colored, African, American, U.S. citizen, whatever. You cannot take your place. Not only because it's colorable, that position, but the people who are quote unquote in power, they won't let you take your place. They won't let you. Because they know that they have an obligation to this great republic, even though they call themselves democracy. And once the republic stands, then democracy falls. But if the republic doesn't stand, then we're here. Democracy is here forever. Right? There is no favorites in any of the temples, for the law is laid down, and everyone who claims a part of the work must be governed accordingly. All are one. There is but one temple in this nation, and there is but one prophet for the temples. I come to speak to all nations. I come to speak to all nations. So then Moors can't take the position of the, no dwelling in ours and does without nobody else. Because I don't hear Buddhists playing Buddha. I don't hear Muslims playing Muhammad is theirs, nobody else can't study him, nobody can't have any access to him. Right? Even Christians don't claim Jesus as theirs. But Moors, they own the prophet. Oh, you didn't get it? Oh no, you can't talk about no majority here, not a Moor. Everybody's Moors. And the temple doesn't make you that. That's just what you are. We assumed that we were Negro, Black, Colored, everything else. But the reality is that we're Moors. And then if we're Moors, then we should have certain things. Just like everybody else calls themselves, somebody says they're Chinese, they got certain stuff that goes along with being Chinese. Right? Whoever. Atheists, they have their own stuff that they know. They don't have a God or whatever. And They have more stock.
You know, it's funny, I didn't call that.
What's that?
I didn't call that.
Right.
You know?
Right. But then, you know, it's about perspective too, because, you know, if you're God, do you have one? And that is, you know, who are we talking to? We're talking to people who classify themselves as Negro, Black, colored people. They're technically, they're European. So, them saying you're atheist, they're admitting that you're God.
Right.
You know, they're not saying it like that, but that's where I don't go with it. If you're going to, they try to pull those on the border. Right? I come to speak to all nations, bringing them a message of love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice. Oh yeah, put this on the record too. Make sure you go on YouTube and look at Brother Rami Salam El in California. He's been doing a lot of work on YouTube with regard to making videos or I don't know what you call it. Making uploads that are sort of, you know, innovative for people or whatever, right? I am HH Temple. I am HH Temple on YouTube. And he just put up a class presentation with regard to Brother Colette and addressing Brother Colette with his, you know, rhetoric, the comfortable black, and say that he loves women, drawing me and stupid stuff like that, right?
We actually have him going into the hanging church.
Yeah.
Show us a picture.
Right.
So,
the reason why I brought that up is because in the video, there was he had in the video a video of Polite dealing with this Ukrainian. And he's trying, you know, the black guys, you know, the Harlem, you know, 123 black guys that do their table stuff, you know, right? So, they're trying to make this European bow to them. Like telling the European, like getting everybody to chant, bow down, or whatever like that. The European like, I'm like bowing to you guys or whatever, right? And what the European was trying to get up in his little, you know, broken English or whatever, that it's all about love. To the European. The Europeans talking about all the abuses that they get from the Russians or whatever as a Ukrainian. You know, you didn't put none. Then a sister comes up and tries to, you know, school them that, well, you know, why you guys trying to change the guy's words and stuff like that? He have nothing to do with you guys being in slavery. He's from Ukraine. What's he have to do with slavery in America or whatever? Nah, they don't want to hear it. Killing this guy. Trying to do everything to make him pull his ratchet and stab all those guys. Because Ukrainians, they don't play and stuff like that.
They
do have AKs and they will shoot people. Because of the stuff that they've been through in their country, fighting for rights or whatever. And then you got these Negroes trying to get this guy to come into his lower self. That his lower self, it ain't nothing compared to them or whatever, but he will do more stuff to them than they will do to any of these so-called high women out here. That they're saying, you know, violate rights, kill a cracker and all that, and they know crackers die. Right? Not yet. Right? Today, like today right now, we're talking from 60s or whatever to 2015, these guys never killed one cracker yet. Right? I come to speak to all nations, bringing them a message of love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice. In the head of every temple, if anyone has violated these divine laws, it will mean his discontinuance. All these guys violated, they're still around today. All the people who said they're the heads of the temple, because my perspective, you got Mokjwali, and then you got Moors. Even, you know, Even though it's documented on paper, I wouldn't even look at Willie Eel as the successor or whatever like that. He was just put in a position because there was nobody else to put. And the fact that so many Moors were disgruntled with Muhammad Ali for picking me to you shows that it wasn't about his knowledge base. It was something about his frequency, something about where he was as far as knowing that he's a Mormon, his sincerity. You know what I mean? It wasn't about his knowledge per se. Right? And he got that position and people did whatever. When he wrote letters addressing certain someone, he wrote letters addressing certain people directly in the letters. That don't follow those guys out there. Those guys are fraud. And then those guys out there, those guys are fraud too. And then these other guys over here, all those guys are fraud. They have no authority in the Moorish movement. They have power as members. You know, they can do the membership, whatever. But do not think that they're qualified or whatever like that. Or they have some type of position that you have to respect. This is me, the Eagle Warriors. And those same people are around today still teaching, pretending like they have some type of authority, right? For no man is to be under the influence of intoxicating liquors, nor to seek to tear up the families while under the influence of evil motives. Nor must he speak anything that will prejudice the minds of the public against the divine movement. If any of the laws are violated, anybody, grand sheik or sheiks, can file charges against the violation to the grand body over which the prophet presides. This power is vested in several more sheiks for the protection of your temple and the divine movement. The prophet will draw you. And lastly, and oh yeah, keep in mind too that all these readings are to be read in every meeting. If you take a tally of all the Moorish science temples right now, you'll realize that they don't have meetings, they have service. So if they have service, then that means that they're in complete violation of Holy Quran, because the Lord God said give Christianity back. We don't do service. And then if they're claiming that it's a service, then, you know, who's the provider of the service? Which is really supposed to be those people who are in the heavens. But if the people aren't told that, right, this is why there's so many issues right now with the Moorish movement, with people making these statements, so what, where the Moors got? How about the Moors don't got nothing? Why am I going to be a Moor if you guys don't have whatever for me? Well, you watch the those three black guys who've been telling you guys that you're black for the past how much of a long. And not telling you that anymore. Right? Where's the black guy's name? They don't have no name. Where's the black guy's, you know what I mean? Army. But they're not gonna question them. They're gonna question Moors, where's the Moor stuff? But black guys don't have that stuff either. How come you're not questioning them? It shows you the bias that people have against it. And the bias that people have against is because of people who've been presenting this from a wrong perspective for 100 years. 100 years, they've been teaching wrong what this is. And then you want to know how come we want to why we have problems, why people get shot or whatever. Prophet warns all Muslims to be read in every meeting. I hereby inform all members that they must end all radical speeches while at work, in their homes, or on the streets. We are for peace and not destruction. Stop flashing your cards at Europeans, it causes confusion. Remember, your card is for your salvation. Failure to obey these orders will be of severe consequence. We are for love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice. We are for love, truth, peace, freedom, and when these principles are violated, justice must then take its course. Any member or group of members who hold malicious feelings toward the temple or the prophet, or to violate the divine covenant of the Moorish movement, will receive their reward from Allah for their unjust deeds. All true Moors will and must obey the law laid down to them by their prophet. If they lose confidence in their prophet, they should turn in their cardinal button, cease wearing their turban and fez, and return to the state where I, the prophet, found them. This is a holy and divine movement founded by the prophet Muhammad Jawali, and the prophet is not right, the temple is not right. The prophet, therefore, is sending out a divine plea to all Moorish Americans that they do their part in protecting their prophet and the temple. This is an everlasting movement founded by the Prophet through the will of Allah to redeem his people from their sinful ways. Peace, no withdrawal. Any other questions, comments? Yeah, that's good. We're going to start off with a book called Secrets of Ancient America. Archaeoastronomy and the Legacy of the Phoenicians, Celts, and Other Forgotten Explorers by Carl Lehrberg, Lehrburger. And obviously the European, right? So they know about us, so we don't know. A World in Amnesia, page 358. The loss of our history is like losing our memory. How can one possibly comprehend our inner nature and purpose, much less our true history, without memory? But how do we restore memories that have been lost? In sharp contrast to Freud's and Jung's emphasis on individual repressed memories, Emmanuel Velikovsky and Ivan Pavlov dealt with our forces that may have caused our present state of amnesia. A name unfamiliar to many in the current century, Emmanuel Velikovsky, V-E-L-I-K-O-V-S-K-Y, deviated from growth Freudian and Jungian explanations for the present historical paradigm and its dilemma. In his most famous book, Worlds and Collisions, he presented a thesis that numerous cataclysmic events throughout human history have turned into myth, and this created a real subconscious trauma that we are still afflicted with. This repressed trauma, reinforced by society, holds humankind in a state of deep sleep or amnesia, as he called it in a later book, Mankind in Amnesia. Velikovsky wrote, as a psychoanalyst, I returned many times to the problem of awakening the human consciousness, mind, to the forgotten heritage of ages. The traumatic experiences that humans keep buried in oblivion possess enormous power over the destiny of nations. If the human race is not made able to face its past, the traumatic experience that caused cultural amnesia will demand repetition. So what did Noam Chomsky come to tell us to do? To go back to the state of mind of our ancient foremothers and forefathers. In going back to the state of mind of our ancient foremothers and forefathers, we will lift that state of amnesia that we have. Because when an individual, like if we use, you know, use Noam Chomsky as an example. Noam Chomsky made a statement that, or Morse made a statement that Noam Chomsky dug in the ground, pulled up something, and told Morse, you know, this is where you're from, this is your land, right? Because it's a documented fact, historical, that we've been in this land before anybody else, right? It's a fact. So for people to claim that they're not from here, they came from somewhere else, and then the place where they say that they came from, the people don't accept them there as being from there. Those people have mental problems. That just like they're saying, that Velikovsky said, they need to face up to that reality. They haven't faced that reality because they haven't been told. And what they've been told is that, oh, Mormons don't know what they talk about, those guys wear funny hats or whatever, forget about them. You know, go talk to this guy, go talk to these people over here, go talk to these individuals. All still pushing the agenda of keep those people black. Keep them colored. Keep them in a state of amnesia. Because if somebody's in a state of amnesia, it's way easier to get in their pockets if they don't know what pockets are. If they don't know what money is. If they don't know what a loss is. Right? if they have no idea about what they're supposed to know, then they will always lose, which is why we always lost. And again, this is a European discussion. Just everybody go get this book, just so you have it in your library or whatever like that. Right? Secrets of Ancient America, Carl Lerberger, L-E-H-R-B-U-R-G-E-R. He also has a lot of stuff on YouTube. Page 282, the Newark Holy Stones. In the case of Ohio's two Newark Holy Stones, which can be viewed at the Johnson Holocaust Museum, they supposedly came from a Hopewell era mountain that was investigated by surveyor David Wyrick, W-Y-R-I-C-K. The first was excavated June 1860 and is known as the Keystone because of its shape. Wyrick claimed it contained one phase in Hebrew. The second alleged discovery came in November when Wyrick said he found a sandstone box containing a black limestone rock with text written in post-exilic square Hebrew letters on all sides, which when translated resembled the Ten Commandments on a condensed form, so that it is now referred to as the Ohio Decalogue, D-E-C-A-L-O-G-U-E, or Ten Commandments Stone. The term Decalogue refers to the Ten Commandments in Exodus 22-17 and Deuteronomy 5:6-21. Wyrick believed that the members of one of the 10 lost tribes of Israel built the mounds of Ohio. He said that the first stone found in 1860 was inscribed in modern Hebrew. However, Abraham Geiger of the New York Times wrote that it was the bungling work of an unskilled stonemason and the strangeness of some letters, as well as the many mistakes and transpositions, was his fault. The letters are not antique. This is not a relic of hoary antiquity. Within 6 months after finding the first stone, the second stone was found. In addition to the Ten Commandments like text, the black limestone relic had a central engraving of a bearded man, identified as Moses by the inscribed Hebrew letters MSH, meaning for Mashi or Moses. So now they're going to bring in the concept of the lost tribes, which they're going to say one of them is the Hebrew tribe. When we look at the Hebrews and we see them point to Moses as, you know, the guy for their stuff, right? Scholars will tell you that Moses is Amos, Thutmosis, who's from Egypt. So that's why you have Raiders of the Lost Ark and all those movies being over here, where they find all this Egyptian stuff. National Treasure, over here, where they're finding all this Egyptian stuff. Then the whole Hebrew myth, it becomes dissolved, because we already know that there's no such thing as nobody called Hebrew Israelites or whatever like that. Hebrew's a language. Israelites are Ben Ishmael Morris. They're not some other people, right? Smithsonian Institute, getting rid of all these artifacts that they found in the Grand Canyon that tie over here to a place called Egypt. But they're talking about over here. And then when you check the records of the Smithsonian Institute, whatever they got left, they'll tell you that it's dark-skinned people. Right? Which leads me right now to, because this is sort of like a first that, you know, this is manifesting on this level. What I want to do, I want to bring up the author. Because deal with the American issue, right? Who are the Americans? I could, you know, read from a book, but so just you know, let's know what's up.
All right. Well, indeed, if you haven't ever analyzed this book, it, my intention on this was just to get the information out there that there were Aboriginal people here in the Americas, just like the brother was saying, you know, who are highly copper complexion, you know, these people who think we come from Africa or whatnot. We're all the same people. And that's why it's like heavy on the images. And you brought up the Smithsonian Institute. But we're gonna be going into this subject a lot more with part three, which is being worked on now. As far as you was mentioning about the Hebrews and the lost tribes and that whole myth, because those 12 tribes and whatnot are really zodiac constellations. So you have to understand the as above, so below connection on that level. But when you were mentioning about they found limestone or basalt with Hebrew inscriptions on it, it's kind of relative mostly everywhere in America, because right there on this very corner is an old church with Hebrew inscriptions on it, but it says South Baptist Church. And I'm like, well, this is not right. You know what I mean? You got Hebrew lips on the front. There's no way you can tell me this is a South Baptist Church. But we've been seeing this in our travel out here the whole way, and even traveling through the territory that they call Ohio. I was just analyzing, and it got to a point where I'm seeing so many, like, just perfectly laid out stones that look like foundations. I'm like, bro, these are mounds. These have to be mounds, right? And then, like, 30 seconds later, we see the sign, Moundsville. I'm like, yeah, these are mounds. There's no doubt, there's no denying that. So there are some images in here that was on display at the Smithsonian American Art Museum or whatnot, which, you know, a lot of artifacts are being hidden and buried in certain museums that held this information. Philadelphia, for example, so-called Philadelphia, for example, there was a Moorish palace there, whereas they literally buried the foundation. So whereas it used to be horse and carriageways, you don't see that anymore. You just see what looks like a building on the hill. But there's levels under that, just as well as we were traveling here. We made a couple of stops in so-called Pittsburgh, was one of them. And we saw some buildings, and it was no denying, when you get close up on a building, they had like these little gates, whereas it's concrete, you're talking about the street, and then when you get up on a building, there's like a gate, no different than a cellar that goes, like an outdoor cellar. But when you look down the gate, there's two stories of windows, which means that that's not the foundation. Right. You know what I mean? It's two stories under that, which still, you know, show that there was other purposes for those buildings and that they're more ancient than what they're claiming to be. So as we all know, we are the true Americans. We are the Amerindians, and this is our ancestral state. And if I could correlate what that means in any sense, is that we are really the only ones that have territorial jurisdiction, regardless of what Europeans claim. Like, they claim that this area is Ohio. But we know when we do the history that our ancestors used that appellation to refer to something beautiful. Also, while we're here, on the way up, it was just itching my brain to know, what does Cincinnati even mean? Like, we're going to Port Cincinnati. What does it mean? And from what I got back from it, it meant curly hair. That's what I got back from it. I don't know if you all researched it being out there, but it stood out to me because we are the ones with the kinky hair, et cetera. You already know our description. So all of these things stood out to me. I know, you know, there are artifacts everywhere. You don't necessarily have to go to a museum. I mean, just looking at that building on the corner, that's an artifact.
that's a museum. It's a lot of history. I haven't seen everything, but I know y'all are all familiar, more familiar than I am. But it's always important to travel with your eyes wide open, already knowing who you are, so that when you see certain things, they don't just stick with you if it's not correct. You know what I mean? Prime example, that quote, South Baptist Church. It's not ever going to sit right, you know what I mean? Because we know better than that, that the Ebrees are really cousins of Moabites, Moors. We are all family. So just knowing when you see your history, you know, you have to have your eyes wide open, which is why it's important to study beforehand, you know, so that when you do see, when you do scan them in, you already know that that's a Moorish building. I can tell by the architecture, it's probably history in the building. If you get a chance to go in and analyze with your eyes wide open, you know, these are different things that will bring revelations to you that you would never get in school. Not ever again, not in the European institutions anyway. The children are never going to get it in those institutions either. So with that being said, like, there is a big responsibility on our hands. Like you said, other nations don't do this like that. They teach their history, but I think maybe we can say we were and still are the largest empire, so we felt a little harder, you know what I mean, than certain people who might have got just removed from their village or whatnot. Like, all of this history is interrelated to the Moorish Empire. So knowing yourself, knowing that Moor and American is the same thing, knowing that American and Al-Moroccan is the same thing. You don't get confused when they start talking Native American, you know what I mean? You already know they're talking about Aboriginal Al-Moroccans, really. So this is why it's important for you to know. And certain situations, you know, whereas quote-unquote Indians, you know, when we claim to be who we are, true Americans, Al-Moroccans, it threatens the lie of the Indians, you know what I mean? Being the natives, which is why I found it imperative to put the general reference right here, like before we even really went in, before I even really went in on the front page. It was a general reference, but it was to show that they already know that they're not, that the Aboriginal people here are not Indians. So again, we can start refining with words. And I'll quote this from page 3 of the book. The application of the term Indian originated with Christopher Columbus. There the Americas came to be known as the West Indies. And then it says the unitary idea of Indians was not originally shared by indigenous peoples. Because a lot of times when people don't know etymology or the meaning of words, they find a way to play on words to make it mean something that doesn't. So they say, oh, well, you know, Indian just means indigenous. No, it doesn't. It definitely does not. Indigenous means indigenous. You know? Indo, or, you know, mean Aboriginal means Aboriginal. So these are things that you find people playing. It's nothing wrong, I don't want to say semantics, because semantics is the science of words. They're not doing that, but they'll blame you for that if you break down the etymology. Be like, come on, man, you're playing semantics. Like, no, that's the science of words. If you're going to say something, you should know the science behind it. You know what I mean? Some people believe in belief. Some people deal with science. You know what I mean? But that's really the only thing that's gonna fix this is reference points. And that's why I like this book. Is just filled with a lot of reference points. It's not just rambling. Even though it's not big, it's a lot of truth in a small package. And I mean, I say that to say this. If you had a constitution, you can fit it in your pocket, right? That's the law of the land. If you could fit the law of the land in your pocket and defend your rights, it's not about really how much information you get. It's about how valuable is that information, really. You know what I mean? Because somebody could write a 1,000-page book full of falsehood. Again, if you read Behold the Pale Horse, it says if there's a mountain of lies, if you take a piece of truth and sit it on the mountain of lies, the mountain of lies will crumble and the sound will reverberate and wake up people who never intended to be waking up, because the falsehood cannot stand amongst the truth. So again, all of this is interrelated to our nationality, even with the letter that was read in the beginning about being American citizens. This is what Noble Drew Ali said. He said, you know, get back to the American citizenship, and that there's no need for the application of the 14th, 15th Amendment. And if you look at that text explicitly, it says all persons born or naturalized within the United States are citizens of the United States in state wherein they reside. But if you look at it, a lot of these whole states weren't even existing when the Constitution was ratified. So what is the land called? Who are those? Who are they? Asiatics is one of the most ancient recorded names. Yeah, absolutely, and I'll read that for the record. All right, so American, for those who do not know, and I'm pretty sure there are a lot who do, but the definition of American is an Aboriginal or one of the various copper-colored natives found on the American continent by Europeans, which is the original application of the name. The reference is there, the reference is on rvbaypublications.com. But the thing is, this is not Ms. Raheem saying this, this is not myself, this is not Cujo. These are reference points that the Europeans are telling you themselves, you know what I mean? So this is why I can't really connect with everything that a European says is a falsehood. Because they'll tell you the truth in different formats, you know what I mean? We were speaking on that earlier. There's different types of languages. You got written language, spoken language, body language, sign language, all of these things. They communicate with us in a whole different language. They'll put it in a movie like The Matrix and have you think it's entertaining, but they're telling you something, you know what I mean? They're speaking to you on a whole different level, like, but they're telling our story. So with that being said, these are just reference points where you can clearly see that yes, Europeans have been trying to tell the truth. Some of them, Moors have been trying to tell the truth, you know what I mean? But examine the references and come to your own conclusion. Do your reasonable analysis, due diligence, and you'll see that, you know, in fact and indeed, we are the Americans, we all are the Almoravides. And one thing that was really important to me in this book was the picture of the globe connected, because that also kills, you know, the myth of we're from ancient Africa, or ancient Egypt, or ancient Asia. The reality is, if you're talking ancient, all of the land was connected, so you're still from there, really. You know what I mean? This is why it was imperative, and the fact that Mubarak Ali did make reference to our existence before the great earthquake that caused the greater land in motion. You know, because the earth has been through a process of evolution. It's like, yeah, we're the original people, but we exist on the foundation. The foundation is planet Earth, right? So it existed before we did. How long? We don't know. You know, it could be billions, trillions, or just something you can't even calculate, that many years. But all in all, that's the foundation. It had an existence in the history and things that went with it. No matter how you look at the map, even if you break it down to just what you call North America, you know, everything still fits in like a puzzle piece. When you look at those rivers, like let's say you take what they call the Delaware River, which divides quote unquote quasi-national New Jersey and quasi-national Pennsylvania, for example. All of that fit in right together at one point. It's perfect like a puzzle piece, no different than so-called Africa and North America or South America, etc. So yeah, the visual of just knowing that if you're talking ancient Africa, you're still talking ancient Almoravi, ancient America. And we are the native Almoravis or Americans from the Greek, the West. And this is our ancestral state. We have a lot of history that goes all the way up into Canaanland. I mean, I'm pretty sure you all seen the Omec heads that are on rvbaypublications.com. That's from Mexico up to Canaanland. So, I mean, and we have so much artwork, the chisel work. That's why I also made sure that this image of this rock, this was in so-called Massachusetts. But we have no different, because a lot of times people are like, well, where are our artifacts? Let's look to Africa, you know what I mean? Let's go across the Great Atlantic. Like, there are artifacts here that we need to look at to get some more revelations. We weren't just slouches, you know what I mean? Chilling in hammocks, and the Europeans woke up, and then we made arrows practically. Like, no, we were doing things. We was already operative with stone masonry, you know what I mean? Chisel work, plumb work, hammer work, all of these things, you know? Building. And the evidence is all over North America, all this quote unquote big cities or whatnot, the evidence is all in our face. So with that being said, I think that the answer to, you know, the question, or more as America's Asiatics, is a broad subject, but it has been answered for those who do not know, and that's why the book is titled Who Are Moors, Americans, and Asiatics. Are You in Denial of Your Ancestry Part 2 is short because the question is definitely answered. No problem.
Now we have to do that one because, you know, if you don't know, you know, every third Thursday,
yes.
Myself and Brother Misery on Block Talk Show, Sons of Allah. It was the first time we were in, you know, so we had to do the tag team just once.
And that was history.
You know what?
That was a
couple of weeks ago, I went to a powwow up in Mount Pleasant.
Yeah.
Those chiefs, they know that.
Oh, yeah. No,
the chiefs know that.
But
the people know.
Right, yeah. Some of them know, they're just like, depending on the situation, they'll try to fade you. Because you knowing that, you gotta remember they got contracts with the U.S. democracy, right? So when you come to shore, that threatens everything that they're really doing in the background. So now they gotta say, oh no, that's not accurate. You know what I mean? Because their fraud is collapsing. So yeah, they know. And not for nothing, or my fault. No, just on the note of the cover. Like, you see all of these feathers. I don't know if y'all know about these rituals, but this is not like the highest crown for Moors. It's an honorary crown. You will only get feathers like this if you put in work. And when I say put in work, it had to be either through war chiefdom or contributing something to the society, to the family as a whole. Like, so if you bring, like, let's say your family might be in need, they might have kidnapped somebody. You know what I mean? If you're making sure that this family is being sustained and this tribe is sustained in that tribe, it was an honor to get a quote, eagle feather or whatnot. And you'll see that explained more in part 3. But this is why even to this day, only the native Al-Moroccans can really have quote unquote eagle feathers without the US democracy trying to infringe or restrict somebody's liberty. Not to say it's illegal, but that's just an example of what's on the de facto books, that they can't take that custom away.
No.
They know that that's a custom. So, yeah.
Islam is the one.
Islam.
I just want to say that I brought some water just in case anybody gets thirsty. It's right there.
Thank you.
Also, if you go further up the street here on Reddy Road, it's out there in like the Roseline area, you will see another building that has Hebrew writing on it. But they're using, I think, as a theater now or something like that. But you will see it, you can tell that it has some time there, you know what I'm saying? And yeah, you will see the Hebrew writing right on top of that as well. But I see that in a lot of buildings when I ride around Cincinnati, corporations known as Cincinnati.
Right.
Yeah. There's a book called The Dictionary of Angels. And they have angelic script in that book. And angelic script is often mistaken for Hebrew letters.
Because it's still Asiatic.
Right.
Just like English letters are really Latin letters. But they use them to create, we'll call it the English language.
Sorry, if you want to talk a little bit. Sorry.
Oh, my apologies.
Sorry.
I've got no capability, but.
Sorry.
I wanted to ask, but since you speak about the significance of Ohio, could you elaborate a little bit?
Well, I mean, being that there's quote unquote mountains here, right? That alone speaks to the significance of Asiatic to being in this area. I'm sure if you check where the quote-unquote black people live, there's probably mountains in those areas, whereas where the Europeans are, there's probably nothing there, it's flat.
Right.
The because our people gravitate to their culture, whether they know of it or not. They're going to go towards it, you know. What's the spot where we went last year on the hill? Or
In Norwood, it's a place called Indian Man.
Yeah. And the place where we took the picture with the obelisk?
Eden Park.
Eden Park. We got a big obelisk there. That, you know, just something there for, you know, Ohio River and all that stuff, but it's obvious. Which comes from Canada. The obelisk do it in Ohio. You know? So there's these things that, you know, like Brother Bill was saying, once we're looking at things with our eyes open, because we know our culture, the whole landscape changes. We need to go back to Africa. The sister right now, Sister Krishna, sister that we know from Louisiana, and she's been pretty much traveling from Louisiana south for maybe the past like 2 months or whatever. And the amount of stuff that she found about her own culture being on this side in Mexico, Belize, whatever, all these places that and that those people know, that the dark skinned people, that, you know, they go that way, or we're late as Mexicans or, you know, Colombians, whatever. They know that they're late. They know that they're not the original people that were here. They don't speak English or whatever, they know. They're telling her, no, not you're the actual real natives or whatever. You know what I mean? So it's something where once we speak it, then other people get on board and say, oh yeah, I back you with that or whatever like that. But if we don't talk, then, you know, nobody's talking. Because majority of people, just like Brother brought up at the Indian chiefs, when you see Indian chiefs today, majority of them got some European name or whatever.
Pretty hot.
They do.
They have their tribal name that they don't use. You know, the gray hawk, black, you know, white feather, orange pigeon, whatever. They have all these names that they don't use when they're talking to, you know, the media or whatever about this thing called, you know, Indian culture. Yeah. They'll use that name in their little, you know, who brought them in to this information, right? But majority of the individuals who claim so-called chiefdom, they're not a chief, that's a European that they put in there. That's how you have a situation with quote-unquote natives, right? Or not even natives, chiefs having slaves during slavery. Yeah. It wasn't the quote unquote Indians like we see Indians today. These were Europeans who got adopted into these little tribes or whatever.
Yeah.
And enslaved Asiatics.
Yeah.
Under the guise of, you know, come on into the, you know, so we can help you get out of slavery or whatever like that. Right now, I don't know what's going on.
Yeah.
They're really enslaving them. So now they're caught in this catch-22 now, because now Moors are waking up now saying, okay, well, we're the real natives. And then the natives are backing up and saying, well, yeah, we know that those guys are natives. So now you have these chiefs now. This is what's going on in Toronto right now. That you have all these reserves. Conditions are horrible, but chief got bends. Chief's coming to some, we had a community event. Little black guys always have their little community stuff. And they invited the chief there. Chief came up in a Beamer where chief's getting the door open. Comes out some European. Oh yeah, chief, I'm the chief of the whatever tribe or whatever like that. And then the black guy's like, yeah, But she, we gotta achieve the cause of our thing. Right? When, right, if you don't know, you can, there's a YouTube video called Black Slaves, Red Masters. Where they go into, you know, they don't go into too much detail, but they go into enough detail for you to know that something's definitely wrong with this picture. That the Asiatics, who are the real Americans, they're classified as Negro Black Color people. And then Europeans are chief of some tribe. And we're not talking like, we're talking Creek and we're talking about tribes that people know.
Choctaw.
Yeah. We're not talking about tribes that you might not have heard of. Tribes that we heard about, that we, you know, put the red man in our mind as the chief, when there's a European that's the chief of them.
Right? And then they were contracting with the U.S. All of them were Europeans. They made sure of that, because those were the ones that actually signed those contracts to put them into that bond. If you go to the Choctaw Nation's website, go to the go through the history of their Indian chiefs, and you will see around 1860, 1870, when the contracts with the U.S., you see those are European chiefs.
Mm-hmm.
That was
like when they had
the $5
Indian.
What? $5? Yeah.
Is that how the Bureau of Indian Affairs?
Yeah.
So like you know, when you go into, when you look at that, you know, for same thing, you know, like in Toronto, there's so-called natives who they don't agree with having a card for them to get taxes off that says Indian on it. But, you know, the chief set it up. They can't, they don't have jurisdiction to say nothing because, you know, they're nobody. So, chief talks, that's what it is. And they'll tell you, yeah, well, you know, we're good because, you know, the chief made us. The chief made us. Well, yeah, the chief set that up. How come you guys don't deserve? Like, why aren't you guys living around here with the rest of people? Why do you want to reserve? Oh, well, you know, the chief, you know, and they know what's up. You know what I mean? That's what really the point is, that they know. It's not a secret to anybody except our people. Everybody's familiar, very familiar. Coming up here at the airport, you know, it's funny how stuff works or whatever. So I got up after I did the you know, go through the snake line to get to show your passport and all that type of stuff. Got to the brother, was the brother who was the border service agent, whatever. So, you know, going through the questions, you know, yeah, where are you going and all that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, going to Cincinnati, what's going on there? I'm doing a lecture, you know, here's the flyer, whatever. Oh, it was interesting. What are you teaching about? I'm teaching about free slave history. Pre-slave history? What do you mean? before slavery in America or whatever. He's like, oh, that's interesting. No, I was a teacher for 8 years. Nobody ever talks about that stuff. Nobody ever talks about it. You know, that's real good or whatever. Let me go through. Right? Now, the way it was set up is, you know, like he's facing this way. And then there's a little glass, then there's a gap where you're supposed to talk or whatever, right? And then you have this computer right here. And then right here, there's a stack of the yellow folders. When they need you to go to the back, to go that every other time when I came, they made me go that way. Right there with Europeans or whatever. Same thing, you know, what are you doing? All right, I'm gonna do a lecture, flyer or whatever. Oh, well, you know, you need to go back there. Then I go back there, sit there for 20 minutes or whatever. These guys come. Take the suitcase, put out the thing, open it up. Oh, you got books in here, what's this? Oh, you're teaching classes? Well, okay, no problems. All right, you can go on the plane or whatever. My first time didn't get checked. It's first time, right? And the brother knew he was familiar with there's so-called people that say European is the slave master, when it was really Indian chiefs were the slave master, right? Who disguised as Europeans, right? Or Europeans disguised as Indian chiefs were the slave masters, not really Europeans from a perspective, right? He knew about that not all of us came over here on a slave ship. But again, he had some history because he was a teacher or whatever. So he had a certain degree of information, right? And it just let me know that it's not far-fetched. It's not something where we have to hide or, I can't talk about it because, we're going to ruffle feathers and start talking about certain things historically or whatever like that. It has to be presented. It has to be presented. The only way, and again, it comes back to Juwali again, that, in order to change people, you must. Why? Because our own books to know about our history. Yeah, we do the European stuff, They're just backing up what we're saying. They're not coming up with something, now we get it because the European said. We didn't tell the people. It's just that it's just getting around now to us. There was also just some chief names with the European thing. Pre-chief Samuel Jacoby. Obviously everybody knows John Ross and Lewis Ross. When we look at the treaties that they signed where they said they're gonna give certain lands to the Indians because we got this is now the authority or whatever like that, so we're gonna be the ones to say you go here, you go there, or whatever. All that is Washita property, which they got in 1803. So how is it that they got jurisdiction? We're talking about Oklahoma, all these places. How did they get jurisdiction in this area to even make claims with Indians or whatever? The chiefs, the European chiefs who they let in to undermine the whole, because remember they were done with Washita. You guys was over. That was 18 something. It was over. Then they had the infiltration. Right? With the Europeans getting into the whole native tribes or whatever like that. One drop rules and all that stuff makes it right? Allowing yourself to get in. And then no draw came again in 1913 again, Cherokee, which he doesn't say that he's Cherokee. He doesn't say that he's Washita, but he goes back to that same Washita family line. But he never talked from that perspective. So now we have to question now, what's really the issue? That you're going to have some people today say that they're Moors, they're Moor Science Temple, Noble Juwali, whatever. Then you have these other indigenous people saying that they're Washita. But Noble Juwali is down that same line. But it comes back to who wants to honor the prophet and who doesn't. Who wants to bring somebody named Wendy to be their empress? Right? When you have Shikshu Fabulabi and the prophet and all that you can use as your reference point, but some new lady named Wendy is the chief, she is the head of the nation of Washita Moors now. And then they're trying to bring up charges against Alina Bay, who's Washita. Who's probably one of the most active quote-unquote Washita Moors that we know. I never heard of these people ever. Even when the Empress was around. I didn't hear her talking about Moors and teaching and stuff like that. Maybe their little group. But there's nobody that I heard say Washita more than Alina. So now that's a whole different thing now. Like, okay, so support, why you get with him? If he's most active, you know, he's done the most work from that perspective, from that we call it school of thought, then why aren't they running to go connect with him since he has the biggest fan base as far as the Ouachita Mohawk? Obviously they have, you know, some other stuff going on. Whether it's agenda, whether it's jurisdiction, whatever. There's something more going on than what's being presented. Right? Because it's a documented fact Mobunzuali is from that line. And he never once said that he's washed up. Matter of fact, he said, I'm not gonna tell you guys who my parents were.
That's right.
Would you say that's really not because that was the issue? I'd like the way you brought that up, because he mentioned about, you know, Cherokee, and mentioned about it, but he never said, okay, here's the friend and program for you to get back your nationality, to declare your nationality and birthright.
Right.
So what I think he was doing was saying, yeah, that's right, those are family appellations, all those so-called Indian, what they call Indian names. They are the family appellations of Moors, and that's why he said that way and kept it moving.
Right.
Because no matter what the family appellation is, it's about the principles of nationality and who we are, and that's the division people are making.
Right.
Even with the Ouachita,
yeah,
the division.
Their own thing, yeah.
And just a new one, well, there's always some, but there's what is the Nawabian?
The Nawabian,
you know, it's always some division.
Yeah.
In the simplisticness,
yeah,
of the fact that our problem is not so much unity as it is normal government is. Nationality, right.
And just that you brought up, Ouachita too. Wabi, right?
Yeah.
So, 1997, the Wabians had a newsletter called Wabian Wars newsletter. So how is it that they have the information that they're Moors since 97, but then when you ask them today if they're Moors now, we're not Moors, you know, that was back then, you know. Wabians, you know, we have our own language and all that type of stuff, you know what I mean? When, you know, Dr. Malachi York, he went to his little trial or whatever stuff for all the stuff. You know, he had a red feather. He was playing the black feather drums and all that stuff. That's their religious headwear, or that's their whatever. You know what I mean? It's something that has been stressed by all the so-called black leaders, right? The heads, all of them are very familiar with Moors and our nationality. Are they gonna tell? No, because they work for U.S. All of them.
Yes.
All of them. You name them, they work for U.S. Anytime they call people black, they work for U.S. Anytime they call conscious communities and stuff like that, they work for U.S. Then this Noble Joali definitely work for the right? They don't teach you about nationality, they definitely work for the U.S. And if they're working for the U.S., then that means that they do not have any intentions of people being free. All they're about is going in your pockets, or let stuff like what just went on keep happening. People hanging themselves in their cell and stuff like that. Shoot yourself 5 times in the head. They're gonna make sure that the people stay as far away from this information as possible. Because their mode of operations is the perpetual Negro, black, colored mindset. Because once the people have that mindset, one, Europeans not going over, right? So he's gonna be here, so we gotta deal with him. But if our mindset's not right, then he's here with the power. Not even just here. He's not about European being here. It's cool. It's not a big deal. You know what I mean? Like, You guys came over. All right. No, you had the little colonies and all that stuff. You know, cool, you know. You left the seaboard and then you made it to the mainland. All right, well, you know, whatever. You did all this stuff to make sure you get there. Kill people, kill buffaloes, animals, all this type of stuff. Did all this type of stuff there. Okay, and then they're still here. And they're not going anywhere. But if I was a European, I'm not going back to no cave in 2015. I'm not going back to no cave. It's not happening. You're going to have to deal with me if I'm European. Right? So since we have to deal with them, let's deal with them on this. Instead of, you know, because we don't have drones and all that stuff. We're not going to beat this European on some, even some fist-to-fist stuff, we're not beating the European. But that's people love it, they can't even fight no more. Right? It's not an issue.
But it's not even about being him, it's about the kind of who we are.
Right.
Yes.
Right, exactly. Yeah. Right? And that's what beats him.
Exactly.
Us beating ourselves.
And I think that's why Prophet Muhammad wrote, he said, listen, I come to take you out of your mental slavery, because it's the mental mindset and thought that we have about handling this that makes the big difference.
No, I was saying, if they take those badges and guns off, we might have a chance. It's not calling 20 policy enforcers for
people. Some fun facts with regard to you know, these Indian tribes adopting, you know, the slaves into, you know, so they can be free, because, you know, we're here to help you and all that kind of stuff. Seminole Creek elections. The Seminole Creek elections, the turning point of whatever tribal position that somebody was being elected for, the turning point was determined by how many free blacks voted. In the Indian stuff. So the so-called natives have an election for their tribe. And the turning point was the free black vote. That's what determined who was going to win.
That was the
Right? Yeah, that was in the jurisdiction of the Europeans, you know, in bringing them in. Because you have to remember that they just like, they don't have the authority, right? So, you know, European, whether it's European, Asiatic, or, you know, once they have colonized them, foreign. They're gonna ask, do you understand? They don't have their jurisdiction, but if you give it, then now they got it.
Right.
So using the so-called free blacks, this is in the Europeans now, right? That are the chiefs, and then under the chiefs, this is the jurisdiction under the chiefs. They had free blacks as judges. This is on the Indian stuff. They had free blacks as attorneys, members of council. They had free blacks as creek chiefs. They had deputy sheriffs or whatever as free blacks. This is in the jurisdiction of the Indian stuff. So it takes us back to Django with the horse. Then he's riding on a horse on a plantation, and hey, don't think there's riding horses around here or whatever like that. You know, not around many years or whatever. if you got a guy on a horse around my slaves or whatever, you're inspiring my slaves to realize that they're not your slaves, right? Same thing, that you have these, you know, and again, we have this thing about the reserves, that they have the reserve, they create a jurisdiction to hide these so-called black judges, lawyers, attorneys, whatever like that, deputy sheriff or whatever, on these tribes, on these reservations. so that the common Negroes, they're not even considering that they're Aboriginal and Indigenous. They're looking at, that's a slave that got adopted into the whatever. But no, that was jurisdictional powers. That was Samuel L. Jackson giving the power to Leonardo DiCaprio.
Yeah.
And why he cried when he died? Well, because that's the master. Because that's the succession. Like, you guys just killed my successor. Who's gonna take over this plantation? Which is, comes back to the same thing. But city or whatever plantation was a jurisdiction. A broad jurisdiction. When you go on a plantation, that's not, sharecropping or whatever. That's another country you're going into. That the slave master is the king of this castle. And it's on the slave to free themselves. If they, again, Jackson. Right? It is quoted that Cherokee land was the Mecca for free blacks. Now let's put this in context now. So we have Cherokees, which are Aboriginal indigenous, right? And then we have the so-called blacks, free blacks, but their reference point of the Cherokee place is Mecca. We're talking about over here. Why do you use Mecca as the reference? Obviously these people were Muslim. Obviously crescent and stars and stuff like that are prominent on this side. If they're gonna say that Cherokee land is Mecca to free blacks. And this is them talking, this is the Europeans talking. Right? So if we are to identify ourselves as Moors, that means a lot of people are going to be out of business. There's going to be a lot of, immediately, there's going to be insolvency, bankruptcy, dissolution, whatever else. Let me say that with Moors. On every level. You say that with Moors, all the reserves and stuff shut down. Reserves can't even exist anymore.
1929.
Right? Exactly. Right? Reserves can't even exist anymore. Which are people are, you have Claude Anderson. Right? Black Power guy. That's telling Black Power guys, well, you know what you guys should do? You guys should adopt what the Indians are doing, because why not just do what they're doing? Why are you going to go there? Why don't you say go do what Ghanaians are doing or Nigerians or something? If these people came from continent, why is the platform that you're going to use for them to get their freedom going to be relative to how the natives did it, not how the Africans did it? Just because they're in America? No. Because the people who he's talking to are really Aboriginal indigenous people. And you're not going to put a foreign concept into your mind and be successful. You're not gonna free people by classifying them as something again that they're not. Forget that Negro, black, color, and all that stuff. Now you're telling them that they don't have to go back. That they came from over there, but they don't have to go back over there. They can stay here and do whatever they're gonna go back over there and do, but just do it here. Instead of just telling people, you guys are Moors. It's like Canito, Islam, Moor. Got sense enough to know it all, Moor, and all that stuff. But you got MVP people today still talking about Black Power. Well, Khalid Muhammad was the head of the New Black Panther Party. All of them recognize him as a general. Carry the casket on the street and stuff. Look at the camera so you can know that, I'm one of the casket carriers for Khalid Muhammad, but you tell people that they're black. When Khalid said that he's born. That's not fraud at its highest, that's not disrespect at its highest level. That these people need to be, you know, whatever we do to them, you know what I mean? It's up to us. I say you better be civilized and stop supporting these people.
But you know, brother, on another level, what you're saying is, my best friend is considered a rapper. We played role in North Carolina AT together. And all my friends in Africa, all those Asiatics here, you know, they go over and travel. One thing I have to say to them is like, since you, the exchange of land is so dynamic, you know, especially monetarily, why don't you stay over there? I mean, very few so-called black folks who go over there don't want to stay.
Yeah.
And it's like, well, Africa's the cool, why don't you stay?
Right.
You know, my best friend, since 79, he ain't even though he's in college, I ain't going back. I'm telling you, seriously. He ain't with us.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So I'm like, all the people here, if y'all serious, take y'all 20,000 and live like a king or queen over there.
Right.
Ain't nobody leaving.
Right.
Then we start talking to people about the ancestry. I don't know nobody who got no ancestry from over there. If I start talking about, like you say, Indians.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. And all that kind of stuff. So.
Actually, we could actually do the, this job, that was a good one. I seen it on, King Ray was talking about that, you know, when he does lectures or whatever, you know, first thing put up the question to the audience. How many people are in their research of their family history found out that they have ancestry in Africa? How many people found they got Indian ancestry? Some way, shape, or form, there's some type of connection to quote-unquote Native American culture. Amongst all people who classify themselves as Negro, Black, Colored people, none of those people, history goes back to continent.
I was going to say, and then if you ask them, you know, like, they said, well, yeah, I got Indian, you know, Native American. Or my grandma was Indian. And I'm like, well, what are you? Oh, I'm Black. I'm Black. I didn't even make sense.
What happened?
Right.
I was just saying, on a little bit more refinement, so-called Indians, since India is in Asia,
right.
You know, not to say that the people here was Indians, but we are all Asiatics in a sense, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But how they misrepresent the quote natives here, like they were some ruddy, pale skin, horseback riders, and imagery is a force. But I was just correlating the fact that, in essence, when you even go back to Hindustan, they say they were Moors.
Mm-hmm.
So if anybody is claiming to be Indian, still kind of shows they don't really know themselves because they are Moors.
Right. So. Usage of American by Europeans. So it's the claim that it was applied to citizens or European settlers of the colonies by the British. So what after the Europeans decided to, you know what, we don't want nothing to do with you guys, we're gonna go over there and not gonna build them honey or whatever, come over here, right? The agenda of the British was to disconnect the Europeans that left from over there. And they started classifying them as American.
Hmm.
Right? But when you check the so-called records of these individuals, the Europeans that came over here, they weren't calling themselves Virginians and Massachusettsians and things like that, right? They were classifying themselves as, you know, white Americans. Which again, when you check white Americans, you know, you got all these different connectors. Moors are white Americans, Arabs are white Americans, you know, There's people in South America consider themselves white Americans. based on the status of white. So again, we're talking about the colonies. The colonies identified those corporate jurisdictions as countries for a reason, because they had to tie themselves to quote-unquote landmass. Because they really have no landmass that they can tie themselves to like that. But if they can get the individuals who are viewing them to see them as whatever this is, opposed to what it actually, what the actual factual is, you know, like American copper tone people. But nobody's really American. Really. That's why Joali said that we're Moorish American. Just like nobody's really European. Nobody's really African. You have to tie your nation to it in order for it to be, right? So from, you know, as a geographical identifier of dark-skinned people, we say American. Right? But, you know, anything on this side would be classified as American. Person, place, thing, whatever. Just say American, whatever. Right? Now, if you have a European corporation, the American corporation, that's not really, you know what I mean? It doesn't really jive. Right? So, we have to recognize that. And no Joali telling us what our nationality is and saying that our nationality is Moorish American. He's letting us know that you have to have that connector to that continental identifier. Right? Now when we check our research on American, you know that comes from Al-Moroccan. So when these individuals now are saying that they're hyphen American, so Chinese come over here and they, you know, does the naturalization, right, through democracy, but he's called American. What's the purpose of doing that? To tie these individuals to the empire. To make sure that Negro, Black, colored people don't. Because a Nigerian comes over here, he's Nigerian American. Oh, he's not African American. But he comes from Africa. And how, it's not even something that they even consider being. Somebody from Senegal comes over here, he's not African American. And that should be something going off in people's mind, like, hold on a second. Senegalese guy came over here, but well, he's not African American. So why am I African American? If he's actually from there and they're not classifying him as that, then there must be something with that classification that they don't want. Because really and truly, you know, if a Senegalese comes over and says, you know, Senegalese, in a Senegalese mind, he's Senegalese Moroccan, because he's going to Morocco. Right? Irish come over here. He's Irish Moroccan, because he's going to Morocco. So their whole mentality is way different than what our mentality is. And then we have our people on our side that are so-called conscious people that do the most unconscious thinking that you can even imagine. And they're supposed to be the conscious ones.
I just wanted to point out, you, the US president is giving signs because he doesn't say African American.
Right.
That's how
even that.
Yeah.
Right? And that's their boy.
Yeah.
Their boy. He doesn't even say African American.
That's right.
Right?
Only if you refer to the Black community.
Right.
Because they refer to themselves. Right.
That's what they call it.
That's so
South Carolina.
But we keep
well, we speaking to their group or this particular group, like what he said, Moorish law about contributions to America.
Yeah.
He said the name.
Yes, you know, the speech. And the speech. I go ahead. We booked that.
Yeah.
It is so important that people will read that to understand it. But it's interesting because this is tell what countries we are. Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, we got a black president. Well, why are you cursing him with being black? He doesn't even say he was black. And this is what we do, and we walk around with this bluntness. He even got a black president. First of all, he's the president of the United States of America. And he's not our president, but he is following the law of the land as best he can, saying that this is the way. But we refuse to follow the law of the land that our ancestors laid down with the principles of ancient civilization, principles of government. But he's trying to tell me that right now. He said that when he came in. Oh yeah, we can do it, the people. But the people still want to be black.
Well, even in the school system, I think I've talked to teachers for several years, when the Egyptian kids come over, Somali kids come over, if you look at their paperwork, they don't want to be classified as black or African American. Yep. This is Caucasian. Yep. Because they feel that they want that status. Well, Caucasian is over here, Caucasian has status.
Well, let me see this. If they say white, it's different. See, because white is a status. Yeah. It's a political status, a purity. That's why in one of us it says, what is, you know, white purity has got, you know, rule of the land. So they'll put white as a status, but not as a race. But what I guess you're telling me.
No, don't look back for it.
They'll say Caucasian. Right, but see, they're not really Caucasian, but you're saying that's their choice rather than being black.
Even the Egyptian kids. But you always see that there's a different culture there anyway, because if Egyptian kids are the same room with the Somali kids, he feels like he's above him. And he corrects them constantly. Like, I work at inner city all the time, and all we had was kids from, I call them United Nations, we had kids from everywhere, from different refugees or war-torn countries that we had relationships with Catholic charities where their families could come and blah, blah, blah. But anyway, it created a division right then and there. Because this, I'm brought up that I am the best, and you are beneath me. Mm-hmm. Even though we're next door neighbors.
And I might have to come over and borrow a cup of sugar.
Well, all that proves is the sorcery worldwide.
Yep. Yeah.
Can you explain what you mean by sorcery? Because
we're talking about what they do over here, what I do over here.
Right.
Because you cast us. Talking about how we keep talking about others, and like you said, unconscionable stuff I see our people do.
Yeah.
It's like, none of us worldwide can talk. It's like, it's almost ignorance.
Mm-hmm. But the prophet said that. He said, I traveled through the south and I've seen this, the acts of my own people.
All right. Questions? Comments?
Comments, right? Yes.
I got a question. I heard one of you speak earlier about the myth of the Hebrews, and I was wondering if you could explain that a little bit more. And also, you associate yourself with Islam, am I correct?
Yeah.
And why is that? Just curious, because I don't know.
Okay.
And then, let me see, I have one more question. And the other question is, if you say that we are Moors and we are indigenous to this land right here, I understand everything was one before. That I have clear. But if we are Moors, Morocco or whatever, then it should be pretty simple. It should be that complicated for us to understand, correct? I got that. When you throw something so simple as you're this, it should be easy to understand. Because you can see this, or you can touch it, or whatever.
Right.
Just like you have other people have their history, like you said.
Yes.
There has to be history. So you should be able to present it and say, here you go, right here. Boom. I understand the book. So I'm just trying to understand.
Well, you know what? Why come on down?
And I've seen, and I'm sure Kujo has seen, many people who, I've seen them. Well, if it's really the law, then it's really the law. Let's go do it. And that's when you find out, no, there's a reason why you're being blocked from being who you are. Why do you think the prophet, Noam Charlie, and others that call themselves leaders with the wrong white name, say, well, you know, we got to come up with this uplifting form of humanity, right? There's a problem.
Because if I can say to this brother, who's been saying for years, or sister, or whatever, especially to the sisters, who are the ones who create the babies and put them into society and didn't teach them who they were from the whole app, that's what the importance is about this. It's not about, you know, because they, that's their duty. Society starts with family, so does the authority to govern. So these things are lacking from the people. So therefore, even if someone said it, like you said, as simple as it is, if it's not in the brain, if it's not on the mind, if you're indoctrinated to believe something else about who you are, then it doesn't become that simple. It's been generations and generations of lies about who we are and us believing that we are this. Like, the biggest one is the enslavement. We walk around with this emotion about the fact that we are the slaves, and when really the first slaves was Europeans. Do we know that? No. So without having that knowledge, you can't put into perspective the simplicity that it seems that it ought be for us to accept those words. It seems simple, it is simple, but there's something else going on. And it's called the mental slavery and the hard-heartedness of our people because of what has been instilled. So now, I've seen people as simple as that is. Oh, well, it's just simple, and it's just the law. And they go over kids and say, oh, did you not know that this was the cloak for us, you know, to keep you in this yoke that we want to keep you in? Brother just said, if we grasp to find who we are, they all fall. Because they have built a society built on that lie. In order for them to feed their babies, you got babies up here. In order for them to feed their babies, they have been infringing upon your rights. Now, you stand up and do it the right way, and all of a sudden they gotta go get a job. They're telling you gotta get a job, but this is your mistake, right? So you look at the municipalities, right? They're telling you what to do. They're stalking you on the street as highwaymen, for real. And think about it for a minute. They're corporations, supposed to be government, but they're corporations. What do they create? What do they produce?
I got it. I understand that.
Now, the part that you're having a hard time understanding is that if this is so simple, why should we just go for it? It's the blockage of the mental slavery. And I will add this. The first thing that happens to most of our people, which I call racism, and a lot of times we just gave that information, we dropped that information, you go study it, right? We're going to go over here to you have your exorcism because you want to throw up on us. And we don't want to be thrown up on. Because what people do is they have an emotional attachment. What do you call it?
Attachment,
but they deal with it emotionally. Look what this one man done to us, that kind of thing. You gotta get clear of all that in order to intelligently deal with this.
Okay. Now, there is no emotional attachment. I understand what you're saying.
No, not that there's emotional attachment.
Okay, I'm talking about person. Person. So what I'm trying to do right now is, because I've heard this, and this.
Mm-hmm.
Now I have my daughter right here.
Yes.
So we're trying to teach her one way, the correct way. So I don't have to come back and later and say, hey, you know what? I was wrong.
Right.
I was wrong when I told you were a Christian. I was wrong when I told you it was this. I was wrong. There has to be a simple truth.
Yeah. Right. All right. Where's Secret Brotherhood of the East? Because it says in Secret Brotherhood of the East, it says the truth has never been taught by a teacher.
Okay.
Because the truth stands on its own. And if you just open the door, even if it's a crevice, it'll find its way. So it's not a matter of you teaching necessarily, you or any of us teaching the truth. The truth is the truth. It needs no apology. She'll seek and find it. You'll be there to support her along the way. The truth is what is going to save and protect your daughter and your family. See, I hear what you're saying and I understand your concern, brother. Believe me, I do. But you yourself have to get the truth and know that it's true within you before you even think about passing it on to it. So if you don't get it straight, don't worry about whether you're doing the right thing for her, because if you're not sure that you're doing the right thing, you shouldn't be doing it.
Well, that's what I'm saying. That's the road. And there's a fork in every road that I've been down. So.
But those are your children. Okay, what's the fork that you think you're going down with this information?
Well, right now.
There's a question about the difference of people, and I know the brothers are going to answer that for you.
Please do. But the other part is, you know about the Muslims and this and that, and now I'm hearing
we
that.
Are Muslims.
Okay, so see that okay. I didn't even know. So.
Muslim is muscles and limbs. See, this is what I'm saying. Once we study and know the truth about things, then all of those barriers will clear right. But go ahead. But
right.
That's it.
I understand what you're saying there. I'm talking about as far as, you know, Islam and all this stuff.
I self law and master. Islam means I self law and master of self. That's what it means.
Okay, so when you go with the prophets and all this other stuff.
Prophets of Islam?
Yes, what does all that relate to when you're talking about Mr. El Bay or whatever?
You should study his works and you'll answer that question yourself.
A little bit, I have a little bit. I'm just trying to understand now why I can specifically ask a question.
Yeah, for sure.
Understood.
I have the same question, can I?
Yeah.
Well, one thing that we should understand is we have belief systems. These belief systems have been put in place so that they can control us, so that we would never find out who we truly are.
Yeah.
So the way we coin or identify these belief systems is 5,000 of them. Okay?
Which one?
Right. It's 5,000 of them. So if you're talking anything under the guise of quote-unquote religion, then you can put that in the category of belief systems. This is why our prophet said, and we call him a prophet simply because of what he brought us, the information. But not from a religious standpoint. We call him prophet from a legal standpoint because he pointed out things in the law that we all live by here on this plane of existence. So what he said was in truth is study the law.
And can I add, and I'm going to complete this and then I'm going to step off because now I think I feel the law, all law, manifested in the flesh is what I am, what you are. Arm, leg, arm, head. All of them manifested. Study self. You see?
Yeah.
Now, a prophet means simplistically someone who knows what the coming events are and warns the people. Simple, right?
Yep.
Simple. Now, as far as the belief, I'm going to say this in a while. Belief is a precursor to knowing something. Faith in what you know is the precursor to manifesting the reality that you want for yourself and for your daughter. So you have to believe, as a perfect example, the ABCs. Because your teacher and your mother said they were the ABCs. Now, Tommy taught me this little bit. It's a perfect example. The ABCs. You believe they're ABCs. You don't know that. She didn't know that, but her mother told her, her teacher told her, right? So she took these ABCs and believed that that's what they were. And then she started writing words, and she started writing sentences with it. Now she knows they're the ABCs. She don't believe they're ABCs. She drops the belief. She now knows. Now what does she do? What she knows. She has faith in what she knows and steps out on the faith in what she knows, because you can only be what you know. So she steps out on the faith of what she knows, and guess what? She begins to manifest the reality that is within herself, which is what she came here for, that you can even reach into her dreams and her life, and her intent and her purpose, not even in your dreams. She came here with an intent and a purpose so you can guide her along. So that's how you deal with the belief. So what they did is the brother over here said, they gave you a bunch of stuff to believe. And a lot of us never graduated from belief to knowledge. So right. We can't manifest in that faith and even ourselves to manifest the reality.
Islam. There's a treaty of peace and friendship from 1787, and the parties to the treaty are Christians and Muslims. When they used that term Christians in 1787, they weren't talking about Baptists, or Catholics, or
Presbyterians.
They were talking about a political body.
people. And those people were Hale people. So in that treaty, Moors fought Christians for hundreds and hundreds of years. They had this Christian crusaders. Nowadays, the term means, has an associated meaning, but the term Christian still means what it meant. The political body created at the Nicene Council in 325 AD. But when you say that you're a Christian, it means you have want to follow a certain way of life, but it doesn't mean you're a part of the political body. So when Moors fought Christians, Moors could tell Christians by looking at them. And Christians could tell Moors by looking at them.
Because it was a newly formed party, period. Aside from the fact that the Christ ray of being Christ-like and crystal clear is really the ray from the sun. Don't confuse that with this political body that they have, see? But I want to say this before, because there was another question, and all of your questions are valid, trust me, believe that. But I know Cujo might want to ask that, but I know that Ms. Raheem, the question in reference to the Hebrew, because you just went through this, if you don't mind. Your question was about the, what was it again?
We said the myth about the Hebrew, I understand what you were talking about when you said associated with the zodiac and things like that, the 12.
Okay. Yeah.
But I was just trying to figure out how you came up with that it's a myth.
Well, first and foremost, Hebrew is a Middle English word. The people are really Hebrews or Hebraics. Those are Moabite families. So when you say Hebrew, it's like saying black. It's a myth, it's not true, first and foremost. And when you speak about the 12 tribes of Israel or whatnot, that's all. I don't want to say it's codified, basically. It's, like, if you don't know that, you don't know how to read the Bible, basically. You know what I mean? Like, in certain aspects, it's like you have to know. It's no different than the Wizard of Oz. You can be looking at it, and everything you're seeing is just going over your head if you don't have those keys. So you can misinterpret it. Like, the Bible is way different than Christianity, even though Christians use it in the aspect to conquer you or have you in a belief system or whatnot. You know what I mean? If you don't know the science behind what was written, you could be lost. So every word has a meaning. Every word has a meaning. In the origin, look up Hebrew and see what the meaning in the origin is. It's in the unabridged dictionary. They will tell you that that's not the original appellation. It's Hebrew.
Hebrew with an I.
Or is Hebraic, E-B-R-A-Y-A. The truth is definitely we can't duck it. We just can't. I apologize, I missed your whole question.
Well, no,
just to show you, hold on. Just to show you how the universe works. I stepped outside when you asked the question. I stepped outside, pardon me, bro. I don't mean to put you on blast, but the young brother over there in the corner, you see the shirt he has on, right?
That's the pyramid.
Got the pyramid on. He's going down the street like he's asking another brother about, I heard you wanted to fight. And I said, bro, what's your nationality? You know what I mean? He was like, what is it? Yeah, so I'm like, you know, I was talking to him a little bit. I'm like, what you about to do? He like, nothing much, about to go get some money. I'm like, well, you should go up in the class. So we started talking. And I'm like, well, what would you say your nationality is? He was like, I was like, you know, if somebody was Mexican, they would say they're Mexican. You know what I mean? What would you say? And he, I think he said, I don't even think he ever said black. But he did say this. No, he said, I love being black because we created everything and the white people try to steal it. I said, bro, you need to go sit up in the class. Because you got the right concept. You got the pyramid on your shirt, and I just happened to step downstairs and see you walking past at this particular time. So my intentions was to make sure that the brother got some information because that's just how the universe works.
That's the mind of God.
The truth is going to get, see, because it's about the youth, and it's about the babies, the youth, right. The children. Saving it, like the brother said, he's interested in teaching his daughter.
Yeah.
That's important because 50 years from now, most of us might not be here, but they might be, you know what I'm saying? And he's going to remember this. She's going to remember that. Also, the fact that sometimes it's just like you might not even be trying and it's going to come to you. Like you said earlier, you're going to gravitate to your culture regardless of what. You might not even know why. The brother has one of the great silver pyramids. You know what I'm saying? Don't know nothing about nationality, but you know.
Right? Okay, whatever books you want. I'm sure that this other stuff might be given to you. But, alright, so just listen up. I saw you come in. I saw it looked like your energy, you was trying to answer to you. You trying to do. The other thing is, brother, yeah, you're going to show him that. He's also concerned with his daughter and his question, and I think we helped answer him. He want to make sure that he doesn't go down this road and then later have to tell his daughter, oh, that was the wrong road, we're not really that, we're not really that.
Oh, as far as being Moors?
Yeah, he's...
Oh, no, that's impenetrable truth. Like, you wouldn't have to worry about that. We tried it. See, the only thing that will get you to feel like that is if you don't know it. If you're just believing in what we're saying, that's the only way you can be in doubt. And as it says in the Brotherhood of the East, you have to lay aside all fears, doubts, and troubled thoughts. And you can only be what you know. So how do you know? By studying, examining, you know what I mean? And from your studies and examinations, you have a curriculum to teach from, you know what I mean? Because you're not just saying, yeah, we're Moors, and then somebody asks, well, how? And you're like, because God said so, Kutra said so, Israel said so. Like, you know, that's why we have the literature with references for you to research, check it out, you know what I mean? And we could just say, well, see this one book. We bust our heads wide open many of nights making sure that we knew what we was talking about, you know what I'm saying? So that thought of, well, all we know is all we not, that's so far gone because we've studied the fact and we know it. We didn't just believe it because no Drobby said so. You feel what I'm saying? Like, yeah, he said it. But he said it because he was right and exact.
He said, man, don't know by being told.
But you have to be what you know. Now, I quote this for the brethren. I quote this for the brethren right now because we was talking briefly. As far as black, we can go to the bank on this that we're not black. That's one thing we might have to correct later on down the road if we teach you math. But the original meaning of black seems to have been exactly the reverse of the present sense. The words signify pale or faded. So we're not black people, we're Moors, out in the Rockies, Americans, all right? So the Anglo-Saxon is black Leoniditis, which means the pale sheep name. German is bleach, Dutch is bleak, Danish is blade, and they all mean pale or faded. All due respect, there's various skin tones, but we all, for the most part, copper complexion, and nobody in this room is pale. Therefore, nobody in this room is black. That's just what it is. So know yourself, and then when you know what you're not, you know what you are. When you know what you are, you know what you're not. And there's no doubts about it. You know what I mean? You wake up out your sleep, declaring your nationality.
The question is more, what is the benefit of me being a Moor? That's really the question
There's only one truth. You know, in all this, there's only one truth.
Okay.
can be answered today.
And that's what I'm saying. And when the truth is presented to you, it's going to be simple enough to where you know it's the truth. And you don't have to do all this guessing and everything else. True, you have to study. You have to break the words down, all this stuff.
What constitutes truth lawfully and legally?
Right.
And we told from the secret that the truth will come through if just a crevice or a crack is left. So we're on the right path, and so it's not that. There's other people that it is that.
Right.
So that's not your case, and I got you.
Can I say something? I'm feeling what you're saying, sir. And back to what that brother was saying right there. After the belief, you got to work to the fruition. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? If you don't step it, it's just like, you know, everybody been pumped before. Right. If you don't step it on something, let me give you an example. And Sister Bay, I have to thank her, because last year she helped me walk through this. I used to own 5 properties in Ohio in 80608 under my Christian name, right? So they came after me last year for property 2008. You know what I'm saying? Some taxes on it, whatever like that. So they came and they arrested me. I'm like, nah, I'm not that person, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. It's a Friday night, so they took me down to justice, and I'm gonna give you guys this. So now I'm talking about, when he talked about legal stuff. So then we went down there, and they were like, you know, you go to justice, and they say, give me your fingerprints. I said, nope. They were like, well, give me your thumbprint. I said, nope. And the guy that was looking at me, they was like, well, you know you have to do that. I said, well, you know, I ain't that smart, but when I was in law school, I know that's a contract. So you're asking me the contract, no, I don't want a contract. So when I went in there, it took me in there, right? So I'm in there, there's a brother who come out and says, exactly says, you know, we're going to hold you down, of course you can do this, and I'm going to go ahead. I said, well, once you do that, I'm going to write your Secretary of State, Kerry, and tell him about your name. So they took me to a hotel on the side for like 5 hours, brother. They came about 3 hours. They came back every 30 minutes. You ready to do this? Ready to do this? You know what I'm saying? You ready to do that? I said, no. So they took me upstairs. So this Saturday come, right? Sunday come, European come, they come and give me this say, da, 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 da. I'm on the fourth floor down, anybody been down just in the fourth floor, right? I'm down there, they come in there, two Europeans take me to the, it's a basketball court. I go in there, I sit on the floor. You know what they start asking me? Can you give me some history in the morning? Da, 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 da. I'm serious. So then I go back in my cell, I had a European who was a bunkie, he's like, I told you they didn't know what they, what you, I told you they don't know what you're talking about. I said, they know. They want to know what I know.
That's
so this, so then it's Sunday, right? Then Monday, they called me early. I ain't been locked up like that before. I've been arrested. You know what I'm saying? That's what my brother says. Yo, dude, when they call you early, that means you got to go to court, right? So I go to court. I'm going down, They take me over there. I go to housing court. Well, the reason I came in there, right? I get in there, the magistrate says, hold on, magistrate. When you start talking, do you have a delegation authority from the United States Congress? Do you have all the kind of stuff, right? He doesn't talk. He points to the prosecutor. The prosecutor says, I don't know what the claims of my Christian name, but we move to dismiss the case. Boom, I'm out of here.
All right.
It's Monday, right? But then Tuesday, they take me back. They take me back that night. Then Tuesday, they're like, I guess they're going to try again. You know what I'm saying? So Tuesday, we were in this little journey, really, with all these other 4 or 5 guys who got out. And they got me all the way down there to process me out. They said, well, you gonna give us a thumbprint. I'm like, nope. So they took me back upstairs, this time by myself. So this is a Tuesday. So they sent all these different people. I was like, no, so Friday, that Wednesday morning, there's a guy who I saw on the Cincinnati thing. They do the Cincinnati thing here. It's an administrator came, and he's like talking all this stuff. He comes back, he leaves. I said, nah, man. Call my grandchief, a Todd Street Bay jersey. You know what I'm saying? He comes back, well, I don't know woman. She talking all this stuff. Same thing. They come back. Leave me in there Tuesday night. They come in there early Wednesday morning. I'm like, man, are you coming? Da, da, da. I said, look, man, it's about lunchtime. I ain't mentioned my lunch or this thing. We're gonna get you out of here. We have to get you out of here now, right? So they take me downstairs, they're like, first I come down there, right? I guess it's supposed to be some kind of attorney. And he gives him a piece of paper. Dude's like, who's right? He's like reading. I mean, he like turns around like this script, like this Hollywood, and he starts saying this stuff to me. Blah, 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 blah. And the lady from the corner, sister, was saying, Do we have Social Security? We rescinded all those contracts, man. Well, we'll let you off if you just give us your thumbprint.
I'm not doing that.
I'm serious. It's like 11:30. I want to go back and sit at lunch. You know what the dude did? He has a little brain pen, takes me out, puts a little drink in my hand, takes me out the back door. We talk a few minutes. He has to speak court. Oh, first for that, lady went up and got mine. She said, you leaving something? The nationality card. So she goes up and get it. I'll be the lady. She comes down. She said, so you know, you have to aside for that, excuse me, brother. This evening, just like that to her, just like this. She shut up. He gave me the nationality card. We went up there. Open the door. Stay out of here. And about a month later, I ran to a lady who used to do that, right? Who I knew processed for years, retired, right? I asked her, if you ever heard of a brother going down to, Justin Center, no fingerprints. She said, I never heard that. I said, well, say hello. She said, hello. Come on, Sanchez, brother. So then this year they came back and they come back with some other stuff. So then you got to write, I had to write my letter and fly my flags. As soon as you start doing that, they back up. That's the fruition that you got to walk. That's the stuff you got to walk through. Because yes. You don't, they're going to be like, we already gave you the win. That's all it's about. So that's what everyone was talking about. And this is the legal part that he brought to us. And that's the legal part that they don't want us to know.
And then,
that's what
I'm saying. And then another thing too to keep in mind with regard to the road situation is that he sacrificed.
Yes.
He was willing to go to take the roles.
Right.
Yeah.
So when they realized that, hold on a second, so now you like it. You're not going to say that you're told me? You're not going to say that you're told me. 100 lashes or whatever? Then what's the sense? Like, let this guy go. We got Negroes that we can give up.
Yeah, I mean, one other thing. He said he used the paperwork. He said he used the seals and everything. Con Jerry as well. Then you got the brothers. Back to the emotion and sisters. People who don't get enough information. Take the seals. And write a letter to a reverend of the church because they wouldn't give him food in the food line with the seals of the nation. You understand what I'm saying? So this is balance and here's the heaven of knowledge.
Right.
But yeah, you wouldn't say it was Toby, right?
Yeah.
What I would like to stress to our people is we must research the language that we speak.
Mm-hmm.
That is imperative. Because words that you're speaking have denotative and connotative meaning.
It's the spell.
Truth and falseness. Also, we got to understand that there were glyphs, artwork, or pictures before there was letters and words. We must study our symbols. Because once you start to see those symbols, you wake up. I tell people, you see a symbol every day and you don't activate. Time on the cable, the eye of Heru.
Yes.
But do not activate. So we must understand that there's artwork and structures that we must see. And I'm going to tell you one thing, other. You use symbols every day, hieroglyphs every day, and don't even notice. They call emojis. I see you have whole conversations with just emojis. That's glyphs in another form. So understand who you are as far as your ancient self, and you will wake up. Ain't yourself up in this modern time.
Yes.
I know she's professional.
We're
gonna take it through and then we're gonna open up for questions.
What is our language?
Say that again?
What is our language?
Huh?
You got multiple.
Is your language? Mental telepathy is our magical language if you really wanna know.
Sure.
Meaning that we vibrated in a level where, and we still do today, and it's called the concept that I have in my mind. That I would like for you to have to hear. I speak words that go through your ears, and I trust that whatever it is in my mind, you got that message. Now, it's mental telepathy without speaking the words. So, the language, as far as the language we, you can go back to, Arabic, Sanskrit, so you look at the English language, for instance, people think that's a quote-unquote white man's language. We derive that as the bastardization of Latin form to teach them how to speak. See, we don't know that, so we think it's their language. We taught them the language, alphabet, and how to read and write, all of mathematics, everything. So our language is all of it.
And also, to touch on with regard to the Hebrew as well.
Yes.
Remember that, that before, before the Hebrews were saying Yahweh, they worshiped Baal. The Canaanite God. They got El in their language. It's Canaanite. So they could play around. Like they're not Canaanite, Canaanites and Europeans and all of that stuff, but they don't play their song.
It's funny, I'm at to the, when you go to the Mexican restaurant, you don't see El.
Yeah,
this is
right.
What
you
mean?
Oh,
Mexico. El. You see El.
Yeah.
El Morocco, El.
The system that, that is coded for the Bible is called Gematria. Gematria, you can look it up. And it's a coded system based on the operations of the universe. Now, they got that system from the Dogon civilization. So you can look that up, Gematria. So when you're reading the Bible, they're talking about principles that you can pull from it, but it's really a number system that is created that by our people. Our ancient, the Dogon system. And to reiterate that, the Pope said, the slave master went to the Pope. He said, hey, the slaves are hiding up under the porch and they all in the ceiling and they listening to the sermons. What should we do? And they learning how to read the Bible. What should we do? So the Pope said, well, you know, go ahead and let them read it, teach it to them, because that's how I control y'all. You see? So, and then lastly, the and before we adjourn, I came from Michigan, so I can see Maji. And I'd like to make an announcement about some things that we're doing, and we want to do them here as well before we adjourn. And then lastly, our language, the English language, like the sister said, is our language. The only language that the Euro, for lack of a better term, implemented was the J. The only letter that they implemented was the J. And they put it in the 10th position, which means that the J, if you have your name starting with the J, is not about the letters in the language, it's about the spirit in which they appear, the order in which they appear. Yeah. So for example, if A is the first letter that the Nomos gave to the Dogon, okay, the ancient ones. So that I appears in every single language in this planet. Those are our letters, those are our numbers, those are our languages. And that, with that, thank you. Peace.
I refer to Genesis 11:1, when it says, and the whole earth was of one language and one speech. Now, language and speech are different. Because if I put a picture of a tree on the board, no matter where we're from, we make different sounds about the same subject. That's how all the world was of one language and one speech, because we had glyphs. Then it says in 11:7, it says, let us go down and confound their language that they may not understand one another. What did they do? They removed the pictures and they substituted words. So when you say man, you don't have a picture of someone with breasts in a womb. When they teach you how to write a word, they teach you how to spell a word, they teach you how to pronounce a word, but they leave out the meaning of the word.
That's right.
That's the four corners that you need to stand on your square. You can't stand on your square on 3 points. The point that they didn't give you was the meanings of the words.
Yeah, I see
if you don't have an unabridged dictionary with you, you can spell the word, write the word, or pronounce the word. But if you don't know what that word means, you'll be developing illusions. Because when it says in the Bible that God in Genesis 2:3, it says God, and in Genesis 2:4, it says Lord God.
Yes.
So, if you don't know that G-O-D is a 5th century word that didn't exist before 450 A.D., well, how are you going to take that concept to ancient times before 450 A.D.? If they said something, they couldn't have said that. B-L-A-C-K came out in 450 A.D. So when you hear people say that Solomon said, I'm black and I'm coming, he couldn't have said that. You have to adjust your mind to filter out because you know language. If you don't know language, you can read something and will not understand what you read. You can read the Constitution and think that the Constitution gives you rights. Because there's the unwritten Constitution before there's the written Constitution. One picture is worth a thousand words. But if you don't know what the picture is about, the words that you read may not describe the proper picture for you. That's
two more book references. For people who take their notes, Prehistoric Man and History. Prehistoric Man and History by Jean F. Scott Elliott. Journal of the Royal Institution of Cornwall.
Royal Institution of whom?
Cornwall. C-O-R-N-W-A-L-L. And Riddles of Prehistoric Times. Riddles of Prehistoric Times by James Anderson. One last one. The Archaeology and Prehistoric Annals of Scotland. The Archaeology and Prehistoric Annals of Scotland, Sir Daniel Wilson. So with that, before we close up, we want to make sure we get to some commerce and some building and everything. I believe we have the space to 5, I'm not sure if I'm rising close is at
6.
But 6? Okay, so we got until 5. Want to thank everybody for coming out. Appreciate everybody coming out. Please give yourself a round of applause for you. You know, brother wanted to put something on the record. You want to do that?
Yeah, great. Yes, I'm Sebastian Lloyd Hogan, Senior EO from the Republic of Michigan. And we're building our own banking institution. We are going all around the country. We're putting pools of 1,500 people together in every city and state on two sides of each city. So that's 3,000 people in every city and state. We want you to get involved. I'll be back here at the end of October, and I would love to present what we're doing to you. But this is our own system because we have to directly answer our economic woes,
right,
and our lack of manufacturing, and our lack of providing the things that we need for ourselves. And it doesn't take a lot. It's not a scam. It's legal. It's lawful. Everything is transparent. So I would love the opportunity to come back and share what you will hear.
Before you go into questions, I just want to say,
question and answer period, because that's what you're going to go into, is that correct?
Yeah, we'll get this off.
No, before you do that, I just wanted to say that it's wonderful. I don't want to say that, and I know what you're probably going to be in this thing, but thank you for being here.
Yes.
Like when you read the prophet's word, you are looking at a chapter 2 son. No matter what that is, read it yourself.
Any questions, comments?
Oh,
sorry,
I just have a quick comment. A couple of nights ago, I was actually doing some research, and because we're near corporate Hamilton. You know that there's generally a lot of times where, you know, the court issues are taking place for a lot of us who are in this area. And so as I was looking at it, one of the things that I wanted to do was pull their accounting records and see about their funding and see where they're getting their revenues from. And so one of the things that first, they talk about the government structure of Hamilton County, since people think it's a government. But it straight up tells you that it does not have 3 levels. It tells you that right off the bat that there are not 3 levels and that it's headed by a three panel party of board of commissioners. So then as I continue to go into this, because I wanted to see just what was really going on, this is what I'll just say, because they talk about the different funding pools that they have. And this is called, it goes under the other restricted funds, and it just says they're court funds. And this is what it states. It says, this is as a 2014 report. It says, in recent years, the courts have increasingly relied upon restricted funds to subsidize general operations due to reduced general fund revenue. In doing so, restricted fund balances have fallen considerably. In many cases, can no longer, can no longer subsidize general operations. Further, some restricted funds are seeing a decline in revenue due to a reduction and certain filings, and there are concerns that the increased fee structure, and they go on about some more, but it just made me think about how they're telling that they're losing funding.
Yes.
And their courts.
Yes.
Because, so they're finding other ways to make it up. And they talk about the property taxes, how they can get more of that, more state and local taxes. So if you don't carry a national identification card, you're subject to paying the taxes for the corporation. When in fact you're not obligated to that. Those who want to operate in commerce on this land, let them. But you don't have to pay their taxes. So I would just suggest if you haven't already, get you a national identification card, do some study. But know that they are tracking the numbers in terms of whether or not they're making revenues, where they're making revenues at, and so on and so forth.
And that's another thing to see. See, you said it exactly right. And I've heard Pujo mention it too. Yeah, we talk to people, we don't pay taxes, and they go, oh wow, I just want to be a part of that. You can't be a part of that without the sincerity and commitment to what that means. So, we can say, well, look here, here's an accountant where you don't have to pay taxes at some department store, Home Depot, or whatever. All a person is thinking about is, I don't have to pay taxes, but not the obligation to why. And that's the danger of giving so. But what you're saying is, it's true, and at the same time, go on the site on about taxes. You'll see the letter from the congressman that says that this is special law. It is only for those who enter into a contract. You see another one that says, oh no, they can't levy the private sector. You say, well, they just levy my account. Because you've been saying that you are a member of their corporation for a long time. And then you want to know, well, what can I do not to? You've been admitting to be under the jurisdiction. Therefore, you are their corporation. When corporations are falling, what do? They liquidate. What do they liquidate? Their assets. You are an asset to the corporation. Simple. Not even complicated, but what is the reinforcement? Right there, the letters are right there. We dug them up. And people still want to, or for whatever reason. And then you say, what do? I don't know. What do you mean, what do you do? You're not part at all. You've been saying you have been for how many years? Well, it's time for you to make a proclamation and declaration and change and go back and change and unwind your private affairs. That's what you need. Because no one really knows what they are but you. Islam.
Islam.
I want you to explain what you thought he wanted to say. Can you explain what benefits of being a war and...
There's no benefits, first of all.
Yeah, because we... Well, okay. Not a benefit.
I know.
But as far as it, because people, when people go on the internet, saw my dad go, you know, look up some stuff, you know, but, you know, first thing he said, oh, they taking over houses. You see the scam part of it first.
Yeah.
You know, all, you know, they don't see the that they are. You know, this is you. They see the worst first, the positive, the negative first.
Here's the divine. Yeah. The prophet said this is a divine and national movement. Mm-hmm. So we've been talking a lot about the divine sign of stepping out on the faith of what you know. That's the truth, no matter what they tell you. About stepping out on faith in Jesus, Lord Christ. All that. Now, faith on what you know, because you are divine on manifest in the flesh. So that's why it's divine first. So you can't go anywhere where people say, well, I'm going to do the divine side and you do the national side. Right away, you know that's not right. He didn't say divine and or national. No, he didn't say divine and national. So the divinity part comes first. So it's just this simple, another simplistic one. The trust. Then people run around doing trust and stuff. Oh, God, I don't know what to do. Doing trust and stuff. The earth and the resources of the earth is your inheritance.
That's true.
Why you need.
That's true.
All right? The earth and the resources of the earth, and you are the beneficiary to that. The first trustee of that. Right? So it is an express trust, right? Why? Express it. The word, that's it. Because like the sister said, the word, somebody said something about the words. The words, you say, cast spells. That's why when you learn to spell in school, young sister, it's called spelling. Because you're casting spells. The meaning is wicked, but it means if your words are not right, that's what jurisdiction means. Juris is right and diction is word. Right words. So the bit, so that's it. You, it's an express trust. That's why the prophet said, you know what? If you didn't get this right this second, tell you what, you don't do nothing else. Nothing. You better declare that nationality. Declare yourself and then you can study and get your rest, because I'm telling you now, study. That's why.
Love. Yes, it's my desire, man. Shalom to you. I just want to thank personally Sister Roz and Ms. Raheem and Brother Cujo. I'm defining. We talked many times, brother.
Yes,
but I want to thank you all for what you're doing, because you're bringing forth information to our people who have been in darkness for so long. And the information that's coming forth is liberating. And especially when it's in your DNA, when you hear truth, it resonates with you.
Yes.
You know, the evidence is all around us. We just got to open our eyes up. And we talked about earlier in the Hebrew side, I came from that Hebrew degree as well. And I had to elevate a little bit out of that, even though that's our ancient history.
Yeah.
And I claim that, the language itself. And it says in the book of Yeshayahu, decree a thing and it shall be established. That means you have to speak words out of your mouth for things to be established. And that's what our prophet did. He spoke things out of his mouth and things were established. Okay? We have to go back to the mindset of our ancient forefathers and mother and start thinking like they did. And that comes back to going back to learning etymology and what words mean, so we can put them in its proper context. And so we have to enforce the Constitution. And if we don't do it, guess what? We lose another generation. And another generation, our babies up there. Because we're not motivated enough to go out there and challenge the powers that be. So we want to enforce the Constitution. That means we have to stand. This brother went there, he enforced the Constitution. He didn't do it just for himself. He did it for the rest of us, so he can pave the way for us when we have to deal with property taxes. Because if he did it, we can do it. But we have to get the knowledge that he had, okay? And be confident in the fact that we have this ancient knowledge and they can't take it away from us. But if we give it over to them, guess what? We won't be molested, as the prophet says. We won't be molested by other citizens. So I just want to thank our brothers and sisters for the job that they're doing. And appreciate you so much.
Okay. Other citizens, thank you for bringing that up. Because he says, if you don't, profit no drug, if you don't enforce the Constitution,
He says, enforce it so that you're not molested by other citizens. And that's what's being brought out. You're not a citizen of the U.S.A. You're not the modern European. So when he said other citizens, you need to start thinking, what does he mean, other citizens? Who are these other citizens? And who am I? Which one am I? Oh, I'm the national, the Aboriginal or Indigenous. If it wasn't for me, there would be no race of citizens necessary. So how am I going to be the national Aboriginal Indigenous and then go talk about I'm a national and then go do quasi-national stuff, which is for the state? The Constitution was established to keep them other citizens, like Cujo said, they were coming over. All right, they're here. But because of our lack of knowledge of knowing, we allow them to bleed into to what we do, and they directed us as if they're authority over us. That's the problem. But it's our fault. But then again, we're not enforcing the Constitution. Neither are they. So if it was written from your ancient foremothers and forefathers, ancient principles of civilization, and you're not enforcing it, why shouldn't it take advantage of it? Right?
I got a question for you, bro. Can you speak on this? I was talking to someone. I had a bookstore in Oregon since 2002. And I was talking to some of my customers, right? And you know, Marcus Garvey's birthday is coming up. And they were talking about the whole thing about going back to Africa. And I said, brother, from an asylum standpoint, Northwest Africa, South Africa, right? And we are in Africa. I said, well, brother, let me ask you a question. I said, if someone came up to you, I want you to speak on this. Someone came up to you and they told you, man, I got the baddest place, blah, 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 whatever. Told me all this stuff. And you need to go, you need to pack up your whole family and all your belongings and go. And I'd be like, okay, sounds good. You been there? And you tell me no. All the people I talked to, I'd be like, if Marcus Garvey was talking about Africa over there, he never went to Africa.
Right.
It's in history. He never steps. He's been in Europe a million times. So,
come right.
Well, I mean, ultimately, it's doing research on one, the connection between Marcus Garvey and Lumumba Juwadi, which if you do enough research, which doesn't have to be too much, you're gonna find out about the National Defender newspaper article that addresses that. Mobu Juwali went to visit Marcus Garvey when he was in Atlanta prison before he got deported.
Yeah.
Right? Which, you know, would open up, you know, the peripheral of thinking to make you realize why they got him out of the country so fast. Right? As well, like you're saying, you know, Garvey never went there. So if he's you know, on this, you know, quote unquote pan-Africanism and all that stuff, and he's starting a shipping line for us to go back to Africa and all that stuff, when, you know, they didn't know he was talking about trade.
Yeah.
Why he had those ships.
Yeah.
You know, you know, there's no need to go back there. If, you know, we got signs that here and there at the same place, you know, what's the big deal? It's not about going to work, especially at $4,000 a plane.
Right. I always tell people anyway, if you don't go back there, where's the nation of the Lord, or the Lord in the nation there?
Yes.
You know, the dialect that the people speak, what is their constitution? What are the treaties like?
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
If you want to claim that you're something, you need to know that information. Yeah. Other than that, you're not that.
Right. So, back is a state of mind.
Yeah.
State of mind.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can't do that.
Yeah, wake up, Tori. And then the curtain's been pulled back.
Yeah.
And it's not people or European pretending to have a big voice. It's really a devourer of mind stuff.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's a demon.
You've
got
to get it straight
out of here. Anybody else got any questions? So we'll just we'll close out with two things. One thing we'll close out with is a prayer.
Yes.
And then the next thing that we'll close out with, I just wanted to do a quick statement. Well, the Morris Temple of America, the
Modern Science Temple of America was founded by Prophet Mubuju Ali. Aside from the fact that it is a legally organized religious corporation, it is building on human beings. To this desirable end, in time, legitimate means will be found to dispense charity and provide for the mutual assistance of its members in times of distress, to aid in the improvement of health and to encourage the ownership of better homes, to find employment for our members, to teach those fundamental principles which are desired for our civilization, such as obedience to law, respect and loyalty to government, tolerance and unity. It is most earnestly hoped that the Morris Science Temple of America will not be in any way confused with any Back to Africa movie. The prophet talking too, right?
Yes.
Such is not important insofar as American citizens of our group colonizing Africa are concerned. We of the Morris Science Temple of America, like countless other American citizens, know that we must live together here in America in harmony, friendship, and goodwill, whatever our race and creed may be. It is only from a purely religious standpoint that we differ from a large number of our fellow Americans. We believe in and foster the Muslim religion. We believe in the principles of its teachings insofar that can be adopted to American life. We feel that the Christian religion is all right for those who prefer it. In America, religious freedom is guaranteed to all under the Constitution. We are interested in freeing ourselves and our children from the greatest plight, economic slavery. We believe this can be done by encouraging, patronizing, and establishing our own business enterprises and cultivating our own acres of land. We welcome into our fold men and women of our group of all sections, all trades, occupations, and professions of sound mind and good character. We are friends and servants of humanity. We are dedicated to the purpose of elevating the moral, social, and economic status of our people. We have set about to do this through a wide and comprehensive program embodying the principles of love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice. And lastly, actually two things. One, I want to say for all the people who are our generation, 70s generation, that listen to hip hop music, we had a passing of one of the greatest MCs ever, Ruck of Helter Skelter, passed away today. He died in sleep, from what they're saying. If you don't know about Helter Skelter, just go look up the video Operation Lockdown. And then ask yourself, how come they're dressing like that in a hip hop video? Operation Lockdown. And we'll just close out with a quote from one of the Muslim sons that took the position of standing up for the truth, James Traficant Jr. And he made a statement, America has become completely bankrupt in world leadership, financial credit, and its reputation for courage, vision, and human rights. This is an undeclared economic war, bankruptcy, and economic slavery of the most corrupt order. Wake up, America, take back your country. Now wake up, Europeans. Wake up, America, take back your country.
Can you do the distinction between a Muslim, not that there's a distinction between Muslim and Muslim,
yes.
A lot of people think there is, but I heard you call them trafficking. I know we're Europeans. I know we're the original Europeans.
James Traficant Jr., based on the information that he had, it's clear that he was in some type of Masonic order. Clearly, he was in some type of Masonic order. For him to speak with such such confidence in the den of wolves that he was involved in, being that he was, a statesman, congressman, or whatever, he had to be in that order. So, in addressing him as Morris' son, right? You know, the Muslims are the Sufis of Islam. The Muslims are the esoteric version of Islam, right? The Muslims are the exoteric. The Muslims are the run around the cube and kiss stones and salat and all that stuff, right? The Muslim sons have to be acknowledged, you know, because really, you know, in secret, you know, they really want to be Moors, really.
Yes.
You know, they dress up like Moors.
Yeah.
All their temples have Moorish names and all that. You know, when you become a Mason, you have to adopt an Arabic name. You know, get rid of your European stuff and all that. So they're going with the program. Only problem is that they're doing it in secret. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That it should be something that they're putting out there. It's not supposed to be something that's hidden away in chambers. You know, so it was just to, making that statement was just to tie that Europeans are just as involved in this as we're involved with it.
Didn't the prophet say that? He said Europeans are
involved in the line, aren't you?
But you know, I was wanting to talk to you about this as well, because there's this other distinction where we can't, where being Aboriginal or Indigenous, we are first Aboriginal.
Right.
You can be Aboriginal and you can be Indigenous, but that doesn't mean you're Aboriginal.
Right.
And so a lot of the Europeans are claiming Indigenous.
Yeah.
Because, well, I was born here or whatever like
yeah,
that.
Yeah.
But you're not Aboriginal,
right,
which is the definition of America. It doesn't say the Indigenous people, it says the Aboriginal people. So now, the thing we're dealing with is, when they want to come in and they want a nationality card, they want to be more American national.
Right.
We can't let them be more, they're
right,
not more American.
Right.
They have to claim what their nationality is regardless to the political affiliation they want to be.
Yeah.
They got to make these distinctions.
Right. Right.
You know what I mean? Like, so in other words, they got to say, we will say to them, well, what's your nationality? You know, first they have a hard time figuring out, say, whatever your mother is, that's it.
Yeah.
All right, now they say, oh, I'm German. Okay, well then you have total full sovereignty in Germany. This is in Germany, but you'll be treated like a German national,
right,
while you're here.
Right.
Now that you confess your nationality as
right,
well. So everybody has to confess it, not just us.
Right. And remember too that once they cross those borders and they come here, that they have to, if they can't prove where they're from, automatically they're subjects of Moors.
Yeah.
That's just what it is, right? Once they can't prove, right? So that's where it comes into our people recognizing,
yes,
that our people can't prove foreign citizenship.
Right.
Negro, black, colored people can't prove that they come from somewhere else. Right? It's not provable. There's no document that they can put on and say, yeah, I came from where. Right? So that means that they're Moors.
You know, that's in the expatriation period 5 and 5, and
yeah,
it is about Ipso Juris. We call,
yeah,
we want to do a t-shirt that says Ipso Juris, you're
yeah,
a Moor.
Yeah.
So because by sheer act of law you're a Moor, but we want to get the difference between being subject citizens,
yeah,
and not you say, well, all you all are subjects. No, I mean, we're subjected to our nation, of course. But subject citizens as if being underneath,
right,
something, that's not what that means,
yeah,
now. Europeans would be subject
to
citizens.
Be subject, right.
They're the true subject, as you just explained it.
Right.
They would be automatically subjects of the organization. We're just lineal descendants,
yeah,
by bloodline.
And also one more thing to add too, with regard to the subject. Or the foreigner, or our people, Negro, black, colored people, being classified as foreigner.
Yes.
Moors do that.
Yes, they do.
Moors are going to say that Negro, black, colored people are foreigners, so they have to naturalize, which is corruption.
Yes.
So as soon as you hear somebody saying Negro, black, colored people naturalize, know that those Moors are classifying their people as foreigners.
Right away.
Right? And in them doing that, you know, now they become, that's international war crime, denationalization, but they should just tell them that they're Moors. Instead
what happened with putting them right back in slavery. That bourgeoisie also came and said, you know, be careful, your own brother's gonna.
And let me ask you this, because my next thing that I'm doing is called naturalization versus nationalization. It's made it up. But think about it for a second. If you look up the definition of what naturalization, it is meant for those who are coming into the United States of America, really. All right, so it's not meant for anymore at all to be naturalized in your own land. But check this out. Then it has a further description that the sovereign or the representative of the sovereign nation is the only one who can actually do naturalization for someone else. Yeah. So you are brethren more, and you are telling me that you are more. Why do you want to make me naturalized? Why I got to be naturalized with you? But then it's like, oh, wait a minute. You're naturalized too. Yeah. You're not real. You're not real. You don't have power then to naturalize someone else if you yourself are claiming to be naturalized.
I just put it out there. That's on Temple 13, Baltimore. Just so you don't get confused.
Not enough, and I know it's on time.
Yeah.
But this is why we got to study the prophet's work, because he asked the question and gave the answer. And it's really more or less about correcting what was misrepresented. Because he asked, can a man be a Negro, black, or colored person? And the answer was no. It's something you could never be. Though you may be misrepresented on records, that's just something to correct. Thus, declaring your nationality is the key. That's all I wanted to add on.
Always add it on. One-on-one questionnaire. Cover up one-on-one questionnaire, what would you all these women assist in?
Ours is blue.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Oh, they got a different one. You got the good one. Go get that one. Right? So no daughters hold the sister. So this is to let sisters know how important you are to this. So according to the prophet, he's holding you up.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, and then you know the dirty ones, they're gonna have their own book, but they're gonna have the sister lying on the ground.
Yeah.
Then the brother got his sword.
Right.
That's
crazy.
Oh, yeah, those are the bingo Elmore's, if you want to know.
What do you call them, Elmore?
Bingo Elmore.
Bingo Elmore. All sisters need to get their sword and cut each other.
So, know their importance, right? Humanity is written on the sister's womb. So I also want to commend the people who brought the children here today. I want to give you guys a round of applause. So with that, we're going to close out. I think there might be some water left back there.
Yes.
Right? We'll just close out with a prayer for the people that are going to rise. And we're going to do the offer prayer today because
This way. This is New York. Red Room is north.
Alright. Face east, high on the left, two on the right. Repeat after me. Allah, Father of the Universe.
Allah, Father of the Universe.
Father of love.
Father of love.
Truth.
Peace.
Freedom.
Freedom.
And justice.
And justice.
Allah, my protector.
Allah, my protector.
My guide.
My guide.
And
my salvation.
By night.
And by day.
Those holy prophets.
Those holy prophets.
Mohammed Jouali.
Ashe.
Islam.